Iceland. Again, leather feathers. Right? Telling me. You used to see these regular.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah,
leather
yeah.
feathers.
Let's go.
Right? Leather feathers.
MC, avalanche flow, watch the floaters and rhyme chunks. All I see in dress code today is bite punks. Pants off your ass, but you're wearing a belt, but don't use it. Take it off, give you welts like dad used to do it. Black with no bratopsy, no knowledge of self. Had me in stores, raiding clothes racks and store shelves. I'm from Tobago, never fell for Santa and elves. R.I.P. Gummer, and those murdered by sickle and cells. Big up the thunder, never charged me for one beat. And that's the MO of all producers that keep it unique. They know I don't keep truth discreet. Flow force abundant, lyrics won't deplete.
What's track 8 on Blood?
I just remember one guy, test me, that's the track right there.
That's
track
deep.
That's
the
track.
That's the track.
You
see,
you got
new
CD?
Yeah, the same one, the double CD.
The one from way back when,
yeah,
right?
Inquisition.
Islam.
Today's lecture, we got Brother Hakeem Bey. If you don't know or you haven't heard or whatever, check out Journal of the Moorish Paradigm on YouTube, or you could just Google Hakeem Bey and everything will come up. If you want to check his website, it's allthingsonearth.com is his website, right? As usual, you know, welcome to the Moorish Science Temple of America. We're here to do the great missionary work of the Prophet Mogu Juwali in uplifting fallen humanity and getting our people back into the fold, into the constitutional fold of government, right? I know you were building earlier, writs and all that type of stuff. You asked a question about accepted for value, right? So the comment that you made was that you've heard a lot of people talking about this on YouTube, right? Now, accepted for value is you could say a commerce term, right, that deals with you accepting something for the value of what's being presented. So for example, when you get a bill of exchange that they call a ticket, all right, actually let's just go through that quick fast, right? Bill of exchange, an engagement to pay the bill in money when due. Accept, to receive with approval or satisfaction, to receive with intent to retain. Also in the capacity of drawee of a bill, to recognize the draft and engage to pay it when due. So accepted for value, when you get a bill of exchange that they call a ticket, right? It has a price on there. So accepted for value works like the officer comes up, you know, they go through the motions or whatever, and then they're about to give you the ticket, right? You're supposed to get the original of the ticket, take it, because there's an amount of money on it, which makes it a bill of exchange. You write on it, accepted for value, which means you're accepting this for the value of what it is. And then by you putting accepted for value on it, accepted for value basically balances the books. Because by you writing accepted for value on it, that means that you're accepting this thing that was just given for the value of what's written on it, which means that you're zeroing it out.
Because there's no money
really, they're creating this fraudulent idea of money.
Yeah.
Right? It's also called discharging the debt. Right? So what you're doing is discharging it. But now the trick that they do is that the officer has the ticket book, and then he's gonna write on the original, you know, name, blah 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 blah. But then he's gonna tear off the defendant's copy and give you that. And now because you got the defendant's copy, by the time you go to court for that ticket, you're already in dishonor.
Why?
Because you don't have the original, you have the copy. Mm. You're supposed to have the original if you're the guy that's responsible. Right? So it's a trick. They get us to accept for value the defendant's copy, not the original. When we should be accepting for value the original and just discharging it on the spot. Or pay it on the spot if we are guilty. So another way it's supposed to work is that, okay, so he comes up, gives you the ticket, $50 for driving, whatever, right? You're supposed to say, okay, original, sorry for being guilty, bam, here's the 50. And then he's supposed to take the 50 and then go to the thing and then...
And it's done.
And it's done.
Yeah.
But because of his position, because he's hired and he's getting paid already, he can't accept the money. Just like they tell you on the TTC bus, the driver is prohibited from paying a fare. Like if you go on the bus and you're short or you don't have the fare and the driver has $3 in his pocket, he can't take the $3 out of his pocket and put it in the thing or give it to you to put in the thing, because that's a conflict of interest because he's hired, right? Just like the officer. Go ask a driver next time. Just try it out. Just go on the bus.
He's hired? What does that mean? He's hired.
Yeah, like he has a job. He's hired. Right?
So you're saying that he doesn't have the right?
He doesn't have the capacity, to pay for you because he works for them.
I see.
So he's pretty much taking money out of their pocket by paying for you because he's their property.
I see. Yeah.
He's hired by them, right? So try that. Go on the bus, right? And just, go in your pocket. All I have is a $5 bill. You make change for this and see if the driver will make change for you. He could have change in his pocket.
They're losing money.
They can't do it.
The driver gives us money, they're losing money.
They're losing, right?
Yeah.
But also, it's a conflict of interest for him to do that. Just like it's a conflict of interest for the officer, the so-called officer, the policy enforcer, to accept the payment of the bill of exchange that he gives you. Right? And then with regard to the whole, a lot of the dialogue of accepted for value and all of that comes out of the free man sovereignty European movement. That you don't want to get into either.
Yeah, because if you're trying to say that,
because once you start talking a certain way to the policy enforcer, they already know that. So you're a sovereign, so you're a free man on the land or whatever.
And that's right? What they're trying to do to me.
Yeah.
How I said it was a moron. I didn't say that.
Right.
I was like, what?
I said exactly. No, I said they're mimicking us.
Right, and that's the position. The position is that they're mimicking us. And doing all this madness, accepting for value and
shooting people,
discharge debts and get out the car with the AK and shoot up, you know what I mean? And all that. When that's not their position. They're supposed to be living according to love, truth, peace, freedom, and justice, because the only reason that Europeans are able to exercise anything in Al Maroc or in Morocco called sovereignty is because they have allegiance with the Moors. And they're only supposed to be on the eastern seaboard. Like the eastern seaboard. So all the states along the eastern coast of Al Maroc, they're not supposed to be inland like where we are. This is way far inland. This is way outside their jurisdiction.
Remember I showed you that.
Right? But if they can get us to believe that this isn't our land, we come from somewhere else, then they'll encroach everywhere. Without their visa or whatever foreign ID they're supposed to have to prove that they're even allowed to walk around here. Right? So, and again, we stress the point. When you go on YouTube and you go on websites and all that stuff, do your best not to stray away from mores that deal with constitutional principles. Right? Like, do your best, because anybody else talking about anything other than constitutional principles, as far as mores are concerned, they're probably trying to game you.
Yeah,
99% of the mores out there,
I mean, I know we gotta get on
who
this.
Are speaking about sovereignty and discharge debts and accepted for value and whatever, and they never mentioned the Prophet yet. All you hear them talk about is all this other stuff, but they never mentioned Drew Ali. Be mindful of them.
Yeah, because I noticed them still, like, they'll be, they'll even mention that, like, Moors, but they won't say that they're Moors.
Right.
But they'll just say, even the Moors, and they'll just act like, yeah, like, we're doing their...
Like we're down with it, yeah. When Moors aren't down with it, right? It's like people saying, you know, people would say, go to... Well, you know, if you're, you can go to World Service Authority and get a passport, right? Instead of getting the corporate passport, right? But nationality card is your passport.
You can really travel with that on the airplane.
There's Moors that I know personally, I have in my phone, that travel internationally with a nationality card.
Airplane and all.
Airplane. With a nationality card. No other documentation, no paperwork, no Moorish paperwork, no stacks of paper, you know, like how we have our paperwork notarized and all that.
Jurisdiction stuff is all bullshit though, right? It's all what they've put on us, right?
Exactly.
So
it's what it is having the courage to attempt.
Mm.
Right?
Attempt it, yeah.
And
yeah.
Having the knowledge that when you attempt it, that they're gonna challenge you.
Yeah.
Just like I was talking with a brother in South Carolina that called me today, right? And he was telling me a story about, you know, police came to his house banging on the door, you know, whatever, let us in, whatever, right? And he questioned them, well, you guys have no delegation of authority, blah, blah. And they pulled one on him. They're like, okay, let me ask you one question. If you say you're a Moor, let me ask you one question. What's this land called? This is the officer, so-called officer, right? So why is he gonna forget everything that he was taught in police college or whatever, right? Mm-hmm. Throw all that out the window because this guy said he's a Moor, and then what he's gonna ask him in order for him to qualify his position, well, if you said you're a Moor, let me ask you a question. And he didn't ask him, let me see ID or let me see nothing like that. He asked him, what's the name of this land?
What did the Moor say?
And the Moor said, this is Al-Moroc. This is the Moroccan Empire. They left.
Mm-hmm.
And from my studies, they asked that question because they took off their popo hat and then they put on their fez. Because that's a Masonic question, what the name of this land is. Because only Masons know that this land is called Morocco. That's the secret of the secret societies. Forget all the other information they have. The real secret of the secret societies is that the land above Mexico is called Morocco.
How about a Mexican, no?
Yeah, well, a Mexican is the whole.
Yeah,
right? Morocco. Yeah, but the land above Mexico is Morocco. Al-Moroc. Morocco, the farthest west. Maghrib al-Aqsa. Right? So, got answered? You're clear?
Yeah.
All right, so we're going to get this get this thing started up, give Brother Akeem a call, and let's get this going. Everything's good, fam. So I'm just gonna I'm gonna turn down this volume right now and push play, and then it's all yours.
All right, I'll give me I hear some feedback.
Yeah, it's probably because I have the speaker too loud. I'm turning down a bit. How's that?
All right, yeah, it sounds a little better. Yeah, the feedback won't come over on might be thinking wants to set up a feedback loop. Did y'all hear me clear?
Yeah, we're hearing you clear.
All right. I'm still getting like a...
You getting a little bit still?
Huh?
You still getting feedback now?
Yeah, still getting like a feedback echo. Testing, testing. All right, I don't hear this bad now.
All right.
All right, I don't hear... Testing. Yeah, don't hear it.
All right. So
all right, that sounds... All right.
All right.
Give me 1 second. I was just in the process of putting up a link for the second half. I have something that I want to show the Moors, but I'm setting up a registration form for those who are interested
right.
in this academic endeavor that we're setting up. I'm setting up a registration page so that they'll be able to let me know if they're interested, so that once we're ready to launch certain things, we'll be able to contact them.
All right.
All right, so just give me a second. I'm putting that page up here on the website right now, so they'll be able to contact us.
All right.
Let's see. Just give me a second here. And then I'm gonna start the bit. I'm gonna start when I tell you to press play. You'll be able to press play, and you'll see what I have up here.
All right. And just to confirm again, before I push play, I just turned the volume down, right?
Yeah. If you already did it before, it should already be down.
Yeah, no, because I have it up now, so I could dialogue with you now.
Oh.
So I'll turn it down after, you know, when you're ready, I'll turn it down and then I'll push play. And then you can go ahead.
Yeah. All right. Hold on 1 second. This is all ready.
Yeah, we see the cover page.
All right, good, cool. All right, well, Islam, everyone.
Islam.
Thanks for coming out. And we're gonna go ahead and get started. What I wanna do is, I'm just gonna give like an overview of the journals because, you know, just to give a little background where we're coming from, I've been dealing with the war, really going back now, over 30 years now. I first got to consciousness back in 1981. All right, so me in 2013 now, so it means about 32, going on 33 years that I've been dealing with this. And in New York City, you know, I first came in contact with the teachings in 1981. I got a hold of the Holy Quran in 1981. And at that time, you know, being a member of the 5% Nation at that time, what was forming in the city was the group of brothers and sisters who had began getting some more information, and they called it the Bay and Neal Cipher within New York City. You know, as many of you know, there was a tradition of lessons of teachers circulating in the streets, which we call the street lessons circulating in New York City, going back to the time of next in the city, when he decided to take a lot of his teachings and wisdom from the Department of Supreme Wisdom within the Nation of Islam and bring it to the babies in the streets. This is why I refer to John 13 X as the father, because he was teaching into the streets. And from that time, he created a tradition of street enlighteners, street lessons, and so on and so forth. And I think it was very unique to New York City. I never, you know, encountered this type of tradition in any other city. Now it's a different story, but at that time, all right, so going back to 81, got a hold of Morrison Temple, the Holy Quran, and at that time we began studying the prophet, began studying different Morse teachings coming out of Cleveland, Ohio, so on and so forth. And then in New York City, you had the Great Seal, National Association of Morse Affairs. I became a member around 1992, and at that time, myself, Brother Taj, Sister Roz, you know, we were all members of the Great Seal back at that time. At that time, I was the Wazir At-Talib, which means Minister of Education, for the Great Seal in New York City. So at that time, we had brothers and sisters from all. This was the time of the Moorish Renaissance. It goes back to the prophecy dealing with the Phoenix Bird, which I'm sure many of you are familiar with, which has a 500-year cycle and resurrects itself from its own ashes. It burns up and it resurrects itself from its own ashes every 500 years. This prophecy deals with the Moors and our fall and our eventual resurrection. The last of the Moorish Empire, when the tables really began to turn, goes back to 1492, when they overthrew the last Moorish stronghold in Spain, Granada, Spain. At that time, as we know, Christopher Columbus went over the hills, watching the whole thing take place, because he wanted to get a hold of the maps and the other proofs of what he was telling Isabella and Fernandad that the Moors have it going on over here. And, you know, while they were claiming what the Moors had there, they need to send them over here to claim what the Moors got over here, because, you know, that's where the story about the seven cities of gold, came of torture, was trading back and forth across the Atlantic Ocean, West Africa, you know, North, South, Central America. We had extensive trade going back and forth. All right? So 1492, and take the year 1492, in that 500 years, like that Phoenix Bird cycle, it brings you to 1992. All right? And this is the time of the Moorish Renaissance. This is the time where in New York City, at that time, I had five tables of books set up outside, bending right across the from Apollo Theater. And at my table at that time, I started publishing books on the board. And at that time, all you seen around my table was pure feathers and turbans. And this was 1992. And brothers would come from all over the country to Harlem. So as they came there and started seeing us, it was like, this, you know, what's John Lewis, what's this about? You know, because up until that time, up until around 92, for the most part, in terms of the Moorish movement, you mainly had a small group of elders meeting in the temples, but the brothers and sisters in the streets didn't have no knowledge on any of this. At that time, 9 out of every 10 brothers and sisters in the street didn't even know who Prophet Noble Jor Ali was. All right, so in 92, when our generation, when the young generation, when the new Moors got with it, you see what I'm saying? This was like a renaissance. And this is bringing 500 years, from 1492 plus 500 years brings you to 1992, and this was the resurrection of the Moors. This was the renaissance. And this is what the prophet talked about at the time. He said, when he brings for the third and fourth generation, he also said that they will come, new Moors will come in with their eyes wide open, seeing and knowing, and who would take the old Moors, put them in back, and they will carry out the law. All right, and so we knew at that time that we was those new Moors in 92, all right? And so I began publishing works and writing works on the Moors. I published the Moors Compendium 1, Moors Compendium 2, a whole bunch of different books and things on the Moors. And then I began to write the Journal of Moors Paradigm. The reason why I did it in this format is because at that time I wanted to write a book, but then I kept saying, all right, I'm awake. I was getting so much new information and researching so much information that every time I kept saying, all right, I'm gonna wait till I get this piece down and then I'm gonna write the book. And then I would get some more information. And I said, all right, I'm gonna wait till I get this down. Then it just kept climbing. You know, then I said, you know what? Let me publish it in journal format. So this way, as I get it, I can put it out there. And so this is why I was glad to have done the Journal of Morse Paradigm, 13 books all together. And it allowed me, as I was getting it, to put it out there and document this information. Also, these 13 journals are tools, are teaching tools. Because these are the tools that I used when I was teaching brothers and sisters. You know, one thing to tell a brother or sister something, but another thing to have the documents, the documentation, the artifacts, the images, everything right there in hand, the actual page references, everything. You see what I'm saying? So these 13 journals were also tools in the hands of those brothers and sisters who was trying to teach other brothers and sisters. All right? So in that context, what I'm going to do is to give everyone a brief overview, journal, just highlighting certain points as we go along, all right? And then what I'll do is take some questions and comments. You know, I'm going to present everything, and then at the end, you know, I'm definitely going to leave, you know, a good amount of time for questions and comments, all right? So this is the first journal I put out called Journal of Morse Paradigm. I put this out in 95, all right? Really, I should really say about 93 when I began lecturing, when I opened up that first time for Double Bled in Harlem. And we was hot at that time in Harlem. I mean, you know, the Moors thing was like all over the place. And I was teaching a course for the Moors. We had brothers from all aspects of the movement coming through, from 5% Nation, the Nation of Islam, Rasta, Hebrew Israelites, Garveyites, Black Nationalists, you name it, they was coming through the course and proclaiming Moorish nationality. All right, so this was the first one I put out called Atlantis Will Rise Again. And you see here, and let me just increase the size here. My first issue, I started right off with the prophet. You know, I started off with the prophet, and the last journal I did, I ended with the prophet, of book number 13. All right, but at this time, 95 now, this is when I said, this is the prophet of Ali. Good luck, look at him. He is one of the greatest men who has ever lived. Yet, has 9 out of every 10 of our people, Moors, do not even know who he is. Okay. That was the case back in 95. But because of all the work that we've been doing, lecturing, teaching, publishing, I would say instead of 9 out of every 10, I would say maybe 4. Kind of 4, maybe 3 out of every 10, don't know. You know, most brothers are now, they know who the prophet is, and they know a whole different paradigm than we did when we was coming up. You know, when I was coming up under Afrocentricity, studying under Dr. Ben, Dr. Clark. As a matter of fact, you even see me on some of the old Dr. Clark videos in Brooklyn, asking him about the Moors. You know, because he used to really get down about Islam. And so I said, well, what about the Moors? You know, and then he went into a whole thing about the Moors. All right.
Well, Brother Hakim.
So,
quick question. You hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Yeah, all right, quick question. You mentioned Dr. Clark. Now, there was a presentation or a lecture that he did on YouTube talking about black not being a nationality and all that. Could you speak briefly on, based on your interpretation of his perspective of the Moors and whether he was with it or not with it, because there's not really a lot of information from him out there on the Moors, you know, in the context that maybe it should be, you know, because of, you know, we already know the politics with, you know, trying to be a Afrocentric teacher and having to omit that from your lessons.
Right. And some of you could search for that particular lecture. I don't remember how they named it or whatever, but this was a lecture that Dr. Clark did at House of the Lord Church in Brooklyn. And at that time, because he always talked bad about Islam, you know, in Africa and things of that nature, you know, so then that's what made me stand up and ask, well, what about the Moors? You know, and then he went to a little bit about the Moors, and Dr. Clark did recognize the greatness of the Moors, you know, in terms of more science or in terms of Prophet Noble Ali, I never heard him speak directly or specifically on that at the time. Now, mind you, at the time when I asked that question, I wasn't in the temple or anything like that. At that time, I just had the Holy Quran, and I just had some lessons and some things coming out of Cleveland. No, not at that time. I didn't even have anything coming out of Cleveland at that time. So I didn't even know that much about the movement per se, you know, but I knew about Raiders of the Moors, you know, so that's the reason why I asked that question. So I don't know, you know, too much of what exactly the full, complete perspective on that, especially pertaining to the music, the movement, you know, but I did ask him that question. You know, he did elaborate and he did recognize the greatness of the Moors.
Yeah.
So, yeah. So anyway, so, you know, coming up, the movement, this is why, when I began lecturing, it was kind of rough at first because, you know, coming out of Afrocentricity and everybody coming through that, you know, come out talking about we wasn't all born here from Africa, the Aboriginal. That was like totally as foreign at that time. Now, you know, most people, you know, see that, so on and so forth, but at that time, you know, that wasn't why I accepted at all. You know, so I knew when I started lecturing that I had to have my documentation, I had to have my research straight. Otherwise, I knew that I'm challenged right off the stage, you know. So that's why us Moors in the beginning, we were very thorough in terms of our research and everything. All right, so each journal we did was a compilation of that research. A lot of times the elders, you know, they told us certain things, but they didn't get the documentation to back it up, substantiate it. So we had to go get that information on our own. All right, so here I show about Atlantis, a map showing Atlantis being in between North America and Africa, and how I was telling people that, you know, when they talk about ancient Atlantis, that was like a big sonic cold word, but it was really talking about the our ancient dominions of Mexico, our inheritance and our birthright, which went from Ethiopia and Africa, across the Atlantic to North, South, and Central America. That was one empire which the Europeans mystically referred to as Atlantis. Alright? So just going through here and highlight certain things. I talked about the cataclysms that took place and so on and so forth, and how the earth cataclysm that disrupted that ancient empire. And that's what brought us to chapter 47 of the Holy Quran, dealing with Egypt. The capital empire of Mexico, and that dealt with the pharaohs and the redistribution of the land after the cataclysms. Because of the cataclysms, there was massive displacement of people. The cataclysms are referred to in the Bible as Noah's Ark, you know, the Babel, the destruction of the Tower of Babel, and the plagues in Exodus. All this was talking about a series of worldwide cataclysms, and it displaced mass population. All right, so this is the redistribution of the land, and this is when our ancestors, the children of Ham, the words of the people, Amexa, all right, which went from Ethiopia, which was eastern demarcation line, across North Africa, across Africa to North, South, Central America. That was the inheritance given to our ancestors by the pharaohs during the time of redistribution of the land. All right, so continuing on, this is the reason why you find over here, you got the old neck heads. And, you know, I had to show them proof of us that in the whole order of Africa, we always did. We have the oldest representation of the people there, the ancient civilization here, the Olmec, and it's obvious. If you're looking at this person doesn't look like an Indian, as we were taught to be into when we were caught up in school. You know, you see some of the Mexicans now, you can see some of the features in them, but this is where it comes from. It comes from us. You know, it comes from a mixture of us, also mixing with the ones that the elders refer to as the Shemanites, to the ones of the more Mambo. Mongolian descent. All right. So here you see some border heads. At the time, Now, this is why it's prevalent. But at the time, this wasn't why it's known. A lot of people, they go support that. This is obvious that these are brothers and sisters here. You know, with this ancient empire, here's a brother here, you see he has all afro. Alright? Here's another picture here. And this may become obvious, but that's why they say a picture's worth 1,000 words. So that's why in this first journal, I put a lot of pictures in here. I knew the converse would have been a lot like to read a lot. You know, you hit them up with a big book with pure words, with pictures. They found not to read it. So I said, let me set up almost like a comic book, almost like, you know, believe it or not, we have pictures so people can see. And so obvious, like I told people that we original all day, but you know, I believe you. But here I show the pictures of statues dating back 3,000, you know, years, you know, going even before Christ so called. And they're like, wow, you mean these are found over here with the most ancient civilization over here? So the Olmec Empire was the of the later ones that came later, the Mayan and the Aztec even later. But the foundational empire civilization was the Olmec. And all those branches, you know, like the same way like Greeks, you know, which is a, you know, just a branch store from the ancient myth. All right, so here you see really pictures all throughout the Olmec civilization of brothers and sisters. All right. It's very obvious, okay? And these were stuck in, you see this part in the back here, it will hold to the temple pyramid, and these were, this part right here, inserted into the pyramids, so all about, because you had the Asiatic faces, now, from the pyramids of the temple. Of course, you know, when the conquistadors, the Spanish, supposed to be, can destroy a lot of this. Alright? So going down here, I show stuff dealing with the Maya. Alright? You see the Mayan with locks in their hair, with scarves tied around it, you know, almost looking like how brothers were looking at my 25th year at that time. You know, so it was a direct relationship. Because of the scenes, pictures, they can get that themselves. And so there was no doubt. So, didn't really left. You might have some challenges here and there, but more people came up to support what I was saying as opposed to challenging. Here you see the federal government that set up over there, and here you see the representation of the different states that we over here before we came here. All right, we had a federal government set up. We had, you know, where each state had their representations come out. And you know, I mean, put together, you know, the laws and things that for the empire. All right, please see again. Here's some more pictures. All right, brothers and sisters look just like the Washington. All right, and you see some more leopard skin. Also, this look just like Kermit. You see him hold the thing in his hand. Many things here you see coming out of the crown line, looks like the Uraeus. You see many similarities because the Atlantic Ocean was like a big, big cosmic mirror for our empire, or the main of Mexico on both sides. The brother here with locks in his hair. All right, so very, you know, so what I had to go through is to show brothers the so-called Arawak. All right, and you could tell these are brothers right there just by their build. You see what I'm saying? The way brothers were built, we built heavy, or heavy up in the shoulders and stuff like that, because we had to navigate those through the rivers. But the rivers in North, South, Central America, that was our highway system, you know? But to navigate those rivers sometimes with strong currents, you had to be strong. You had to, you know, you had to, that's to be, you know, that's why we built top heavy like that. We have the ability to navigate all the rivers and land with good cargo. All right. Here you see California Aboriginals. All right. Here you see women from the Andes. And many of these people in the Andes, to them, you know, they always, but the Europeans come and tell them, no, you're the descendants of escaped slaves. line they always use when they find us, they say, oh, they must be from the rooms of descendants of escaped slaves, you know. And so what most people don't understand is that it wasn't like people was escaping from slavery and going with some Indians. We were escaping going back to our own villages, you know. So, I mean, you know, the whole, everything matters how you perceive it in your perspective. I even came across this article here, and that the first Americans, red or black. Now, it was a time where that wouldn't even be a question. So just the fact that they asked that question was showing that there was many major upsets coming within the archaeological realm, all right? And it talks about how they found artifacts, and as we were taught, if the Indians came from Asia through the Bering Strait 6,000 years ago, then the older settlements should be up in Alaska, where, and the settlements would get progressively younger as they go further south, because they started from the north and came south. But what they was finding was settlements that were older in the south than in the north. All right, they was finding settlements in the south that were 30,000, 35,000 years old, and they were us. So it began to shake up the whole archaeological world, and even though they still were trying to cover up, it's starting to break through now. All right. Here's a picture from the same, this is Actua, Canaanite, and there was a picture here, yeah, this is from one of the artists here, and here's the conquistadors, so forth, and conquistadors coming here, and round up the Native Americans here, and here you see Mongol types, and here you see a brother. And the person was like, well, you know, not them, but the artist was, the one who looked at the painting was like, well, what's the brother doing there? You know? All right, so it's been a big cover. You know, here you see this pyramid in Mexico actually has four times the volume of the big pyramid in Egypt. If you turn, open them upside down and fill them up a quarter, it will hold four times more. All right, so, you know, he was just dropping this, you know, Russell was hearing a lot of stuff for the first time. You know, all the stuff here, Amexum. And Amexum is from which they derived the word Mexico, or Mexico. All right? And I thought it was interesting. It says here, this is the reason why we have to begin to field our own archaeologists. It says here, the sheer the earth removed of rock transported and carved of bricks fired in the sun never fails to astound the observer. In Mexico alone, there may be as many as 100,000 pyramids still wait to be uncovered. Huh? So I mean, so much archaeology there still needs to be done. All right? We just found a city 2,000 feet below sea level on the coast of Cuba with pyramids and everything. And this is where you get this whole talk about the destruction of Atlantis and the cataclysm. All right? Here, up down the Mississippi, what you call the old man, the now, you know, you see all these mound builders settling. And now, you know, all scattered out here, the mound builder head, right here. All right, coming from the mysterious cold people of the Hopewell Islanders in Ohio. All right, here's another one that's coming from Canaan land, Canada. All right, and again, like I said, our people's familiar with this now, but at the time when we was breaking this stuff out, people were like, wow, yo, hold up. You know, here's this is coming from the Mississippi River, and here you see the scarification, just like the ritual scarification that you see in West Africa, right? Here goes some more. They found all these pipes, found thousands and thousands of these pipes inside the mound. All right, so this goes back to all these peat pipe rituals, all right? And as far as kept, a lot of those peat pipe rituals did involve, that did contain marijuana, all right, which dealt with old times referred to as rabbit tobacco. So a lot of things that you see brothers and sisters doing now, it's nothing new under the sun, all right? And the reason why the marijuana associated with the peace fight is because it made you peaceful. It made you not want to have war. It made you want to be in a peaceful environment. And that was the peace fight, all right? Here you see some more, and this is the food, this is from Africa. All this mound builder stuff. tribe. This is a pamphlet that I put out dealing with the Ishmael tribe. And I thought it was curious that here's a so-called collection of aboriginals of the East Coast who were invited by their buses further inland, and they set up a migration and forms up the Venice Mayo. Now, something don't make sense here. Like, wait up, we wasn't taught that in so-called Indian urged themselves as Venice Mayo. And it was a migration route that would take that they named Utica, Muhammad, and Morocco. Everybody was like, oh, look. And big thing about it, when I first started doing research, you know, ultimately I did over 30,000 hours of research. But initially doing research, I couldn't find no information proving what else was saying at first. Then once I got rolling, it was to the point where I had so much information coming about the Moors. I could literally walk to a library block, just walk to a wall and find information for them. You know, it was weird, but the agency, it's about the Venice Mayo. And I also found out that America's first eugenics and genocide plan was practiced on the Venice Mayo. Right, this is about the 1800s, time of and so on and so forth. And then they migrated up here in Indiana, Illinois, and some even say that they became some of the original of the more science type of America. All right? And what they would do is that you would take the men, put them in prison, put the women in homes in prison, and take the children and put them in orphanages. And that little question about little orphan Annie, they said that orphan Annie was a Venice Mayo. You see, with the little curly afro and everything, and they said that she would have been an orphan as a result of genocide waged on the Venice Mayo. And they said that Hitler actually studied the genocide practice on the Venice Mayo put together his own genocide plan. It was based on this. It was based on what is the Venice Mayo. Alright? So all this was information that we were uncovering at this time. All this, again, the first paradigm, these are tools in the hands of war. So if you want to teach brothers and sisters, job in it, you got tools in your hand to show and prove. Alright, this brother here, he's a Wapanoag from New England, Connecticut area, and all those tribes on that East Coast are coming back a lot of land, so he's going to build a casino or stuff like that over there. But these are all the Aboriginal people. Versus is from that area over there, Shinnecock, all that, Long Island, all that stuff on the coast, there are more. All right. Here is a letter that I got from, we went to the permanent mission of Morocco, New York. This was back in the day. Oh, we were walking while we was all over the place. Some people in there with our feathers on, and we was breaking the stuff down to a neighborhood haze. And at that time, he was telling me, he said, listen, he said, you need to take your journals, get them translated into Arabic, and get people to universities over there, college students. And he even told me to contact the King of Morocco at that time, who passed away since that time, but they told me something, he gave me this, from the Moroccan mission, talking about how America was discovered by Moroccans 1,000 years before Christopher Columbus. So even on the other side, they had records there, but they didn't begin to pull them out the woodwork until we got them on. I got on them about it. All right, so the article here talks about Moors discovering America. All right? Now, you know, there was some, as we were teaching, well, how do we know, you know, these different laws and different things, like so about Moroccan treaty laws, but how do we know it pertains to us? You know, not some Arabs, but us. So that's where I could pull out this information here. And like, for instance, this one information, Modern Britain says that in 1676, the native people of New England was spoken of indifferently as Indian and Moors, and our British Indians, Aboriginal, are also remembered as Moors. All right? Here, teach process is that the reason why we suffered slavery was because of the divine law of substitution. What goes around comes around. And we had enslaved the Europeans first. All right? And according to the divine law of substitution, what goes around comes around, and that's why we were eventually enslaved. All right, so keep in mind, we enslaved them first, and at that time, you know, the European males, they had to kill outright, you know, imprisoned, enslaved, you know, used to work the galleys of the ships, and the women would go as concubines into the harems of wealthy Moors. This is the reason why it was the Moorish nobility that got out first, because they were the only ones who were able to afford European women who were sold by commodities into their homes. Naturally, they began to get reached out, and we began to associate the shade of skin with the nobility. That eventually led to the whole color race thing, which the European capitalized on. Everybody was considered a lighter shade of skin to be nobility, then you can't get no lighter than us. And so what they did was set up this whole white supremacist, white people good and black being bad and all this whole thing like this. All right, it started amongst us. And it started by us selling these women, let's go back even to call the Phoenicians, selling these European women into the harem of wealthy men. All right? This right here was worth 1,000 books. I actually got this picture when I was in New York City in an elementary school. I went to the library, got one of the history books, and this was in the history book. It says here, United States Army Power, it says the English, French, Dutch, Danes, Swedes, and I may say all nations are tribute. And here it says, an American captain gives his tribute money to the Bay of Our Bears. You see the Bay of Our Bears sitting up here, you see him pointing down and put that money down there. And you see the American captain, he's all reluctant, but you see them bags of gold down there, and you see brother sitting back here with these scimitar swords, put that money down there. All right, and I'm gonna talk about this a little bit later on. But here, like I said, a picture's worth 1,000 words. That's why it was kept. America was still paying tribute, because up until the 1800s, but I'm gonna get into that exact issue in book number 13. All right, again, Here's the Moroccan Treaty of Peace and Friendship, the oldest, the first treaty ever signed by the United States. And here, at that time, it's in 92 in New York. The Moroccan Treaty was like a mysterious thing. You know, very few actually had it, and the more that they had it, went up and looked for it. They made them have to get research and find it themselves. They wasn't given up the Moroccan Treaty. It was like this incredible document, you know. So, you know, publishing like this at that time was a major move, you know. All right. And continuing on, again, people should say, well, how do we know that all the times of war, you know, because I was finding stuff that was saying that, you know, like in the Black Code of Virginia, saying, we'll be subject to the Moors, and suffer more tsunami. And this is going back to 1600s. So the question is, was it ask me, how do I know it's referring to us specifically? And so I got the proof and the documents to prove that as well. This was taken, and this is an act of Massachusetts. And it says here, thus act was passed in Massachusetts on 6th of March, 1780. Negro, not a subject of the Emperor of Morocco, who was citizen of the United States from tarrying in the Commonwealth. Now, this is saying a number of things. First of all, there were those of us who they called who were citizens, subjects of the Emperor of Morocco, and it says here, and here they're putting a subject of Morocco and a citizen of the United States on the same level. All right, because in the Articles of Confederation, the Morocco were referred to as free inhabitants. And when I researched my family went back to 1787 and 1784, their last name was Morris. M-O-R-R-I-S. All right? And it was listed Khan will refer to as pre-happiness and had all the same exact same type of because of the treaty. Alright? Continuing on, here's another thing proving that it was more referring to us. This was taken from the Journals of the House of Representatives. Mind you, this was back in 1994 he was teaching. So this stuff was like people were like, wow. This was taken from the House of Representatives in 1990. And it said the petition was presented to the House of Sundry Free Moors. So to the Emperor of Morocco and residents in this state, praying that in case they should commit any fault and criminal be brought to justice, that they are subjects to a prince in alliance of a treaty of America may be tried under the same laws as the citizens will be liable to be tried, and not under the Negro Act, which was received and read. Here you got a group of brothers and sisters present a petition and don't include us under your Negro Acts. Because we are free Moors and we are under the treaty. And this petition was recognized. Now, if they didn't look like me and you, or if, you know, if it wasn't a conflict, it was going to be for us, then why wouldn't he even submit a petition the people act if they didn't look like us? All right, so the proof is in the pudding. These documents prove that when you hear speaking the laws and things like this dealing with wars, they talk about us. They talk about Arabs. They're not talking about European with turbans on. They're talking about us. All right, specifically. All right, so right here is Emperor Mulan Ashi, right? And, you know, and here you see Prince of Capoletta, Emperor Morocco. This is one of the earliest words. Now, obviously, you can see that he was like any brother out here, any day in the week. All right, straight up. All right, then you got General Bassa, you see the ships, showing the more of a navigator. All right, and he was a member of the DWAN. All right, which was the Moorish military, which is known as the Bokawa. Matter of fact, I put together something known as the DWAN, which eventually was going to form like the Moor Scouts for the young brothers. All right, and he can see the pearl earring in his ear. Whenever and you was born into the D-Wan, you had to be into the D-Wan military. And every time one was born, he had a pearl earring. Right? And this blew people's mind here. The actual letter, this is the handwritten letter from George Washington to the from Morocco in his own handwriting. When he addresses the Begad, did great as having friends. All right, and I got the full context of the letter in book number 5, full actual letter in, you know, typewritten, so it's easier. But here it is in his own handwriting. So all this begins to, like, blow brothers' mind. They never came in contact with this information like this before. And we had documented evidence. I was backing this stuff up with documented evidence. All right? And so here again, I ended this first talking to Udwali, all right, talking about how he reclaimed everything that was taken from us and it was put to the form of a trust. All right? So we'll get more into that place. That was the first book. That was book one. I spent a little extra time on that one because that was the first one. I was doing like a landmark and it had a lot of important things in it. I'm going to go a little faster for these next couple of ones. Just highlighting certain things in them, all right? 13 of these all together, and believe me, it's a lot right these books. It wasn't easy, you know, a lot. I mean, I went through a lot to actually put these books together. The second one was called Truth is Stranger Than Fiction, all right? And in this one, I came across some information about the Ramapo Mountain. And these are a group of brothers and sisters up in the Ramapo Mountains, who was originally part of the Tuscarora tribe in North Carolina. And they was invited, because they was down there, they was invited up north. And I don't know if you can, I don't know if it's feedback, or if you can have some noise in the background, I don't know what that is, but they was invited north. Yeah, I'm getting a little feedback. I've been getting still, it for a while, but I was hoping to stop.
Well, you still getting it?
Yeah, I'm
just
looking at
the
news. I'm just like,
weird
noise keeps coming through. I don't know if it's
good
or not.
Why don't you try with the microphone off again? Or is the microphone on?
No, it's not. We're not running that way. We're just talking right away.
No, but it's not.
It's not on. It's not on.
Well, I'm right here. I'll let you know.
All right.
So this is around the whole mountain people. And they was, instead of across the world, we were invited by the Air Force Confederacy north into New York. In the Ramapo Mountain area. And the Europeans who studied them say, oh, they say that they're just going to send it to the top of the world. The Europeans say, oh, they're just going to escape blacks, free blacks, escape blacks again. This is the game that they play. All right? And this is the game that they've been playing for a long time. All right? So naturally, and then they pass all these laws against so-called, quote-unquote, blacks or Negroes. So naturally, these people, they don't want to be associated with that. So they tell the government, no, we're not blacks, or whatever, right? They're not saying that they are not who they are. They're not us. They're saying that they don't want to be included under those black laws that the Europeans created, those Negro laws, all right? And so, but this is the game that's been played, all right? Obviously, you can see that these brother sisters, Tuscarora, all right? And I found this book when I was up on Bear Mountain in New York. And the elders just let me, something just told me, the elders, the ancestors just told me to go into the bookstore. When I went to the bookstore, boom, the book was sitting right there, like, just calling my name, you know. And so here, what's interesting, right, is that all these millions and millions of so-called Indians that they say was destroyed, was, you know, was killed as a result of the Europeans coming here, the anthropologist said, no. They didn't disappear. They became the so-called black population of America today. They didn't disappear. This is an aboriginal from Ramapo named Ed Morgan. In 1889, James Mooney, an anthropologist working for the Smithsonian Institute, remember Smithsonian Institute was involved with a lot of cover-ups too, did research on Indian culture and survivors, and he came to the conclusion that there was undoubtedly considerable Indian ancestry among blacks in the southern coastal plain region. Regarding the powerful Powhatan Confederacy, this is the one that dealt with Smith, James Smith and everything, Virginia and everything. And if they would have killed, if the Powhatans would have killed, and this is going to Pocahontas, if they would have killed us at that time, there would be the United States of America as we know now. All right? Powhatan, the Chickahominy, the Mattaponi, the Nassaman, the Nottoway, the Pamunkey, the Potomac, the Wampanoag, who held dominion in this region around Virginia. Thomas Jefferson in 1785 was recorded as saying that the Mattaponis have more Negro than Indian blood in them. Of course, he was just going by what he visually seen. He seen that they were straight up like us. This is a play on words because of the rest and so forth. Now it says here in the book, they said this is a plan, let me read this part. They said that this is a plan of words because what he refers to as Negro and Indian is born to the same people, only victims of the divide and conquer strategy. This color-based white society caused many psychological problems among our people. In a book called Personality in the White Indian Negro Community, so-called Tri-Racial Isolate, American Sociological Review, Guy B. Johnson says that the Croatan and Lumbee of Robeson County, North Carolina, have problems of personal adjustment, such as come to terms with Negroid physical features and the color-based white society. So here you're talking about those Aboriginals in North Carolina, which my family's from as well, having problems because of this whole, you know, racial thing. This one here talks about the Navajo and more folk medicine. And it says the Delaware, Shawnee, Seneca, Mohican, and other Eastern Indians claim that their forebears originally received their knowledge of Mohawk-Pasikan from a tribe called the Nanticoke. And this is the same area where they should refer to themselves as Moors. And when I read about some of their medicines, one of their medicines was the exact same medicine that my grandmother used for cold. And it was one of their folk medicines. All right. So again, this whole connection. action here. All right. Here's some more coming from the Hopewells. All right. This is what I want to read. James Hugo Johnson, in the book Journal of Negro Ancestry, volume number 14, concluded, based on his research, that the Indian has not disappeared from the land, but is now part of the Negro population of the United States. So, you know, your book still talking about, you know, the Indians, they disappeared. You know, another person suggesting that they were just killed off. He's saying, no, they're not the so-called Negro population of the United States. All right? But anyway, here I talk about some other things. You know, that's why I call this truth, strange, and fiction. You know, we were taught that the Vikings were these, you know, barbaric Europeans and so on and so forth, when really they were tied with the Danes and those Moorish nobles in that part of North Europe. All right? It says here, in ancient modern Britain, it seems likely that the Creekmen or pirates were chiefly of the races of Simbri or Black Danes and Morai or Blackamoors. He also said on the same page, they are better known in modern history under their general designation of Thick Vikings or Thick Kings or Creekmen. All right? The white Europeans, so-called white Europeans found amongst the Vikings were the white, so-called white serfs and peasants that David McRitchie said the Danes and Vikings were terrorized and kidnapped. These Moors or Danes also made them pay a tribute called the Dane Bell, which was later derived the term blackmail. So when you hear this term blackmail was really a reference to the tribute that was paid to the so-called Black Army or Moors in Europe. All right? And they are presented to us as piratical Thick Kings or Creekmen, Thick descendants of those Black heathens that murdered, robbed, and burned all along our shores as far back as the 9th century. That's from David Rich, Eastern Water Brick. All right. Here we have a Moorish brazier found among the remains of the Vikings. This is a picture of brazier. The maritime people called Danes, Vikings, and Blackamoor are the same Moors found along the rivers and creeks of the eastern coast of the United States and called Indians. All right? These are the remnants of that ancient Atlantean empire, the remains of the Mexicans that spanned the Atlantic and dominated the land on both sides. We are the direct descendants of these Moors. David McRitchie speaks of the Moors, the Indians, and Britain as being the same in appearance and culture as the ones here in this hemisphere. This is what accounts for all you hear from Europeans now about Vikings and Norse discovering America. Well, I got news for them. Those so-called Vikings that you talk about were originally Moors. The Moorish paradigm is like Moses' rod. It is definitely swallowing up all other paradigms. Here you got a picture, again, of Moorish nobility coming out of Europe. This is a picture of a Moorish Norman knight and his European concubine wife. All right, this is Norman. All right, and so I just put that in there so people know that, you know, truth is treason and fiction. You know, a lot of stuff that we were taught is actually the opposite. All right, here you got more pictures here. All right, so I'm just going through this kind of quickly. All right, just touch on certain points. And the David Ritchie, ancient modern Britain, he says, the Englishmen who had colonized the western shore of the Atlantic not more than a generation or two before Gross spoke of the Indians there as being as black as gypsies. In 1676, the native race of New England was spoken of indifferently as Indians and Moors, and our British Indians are also remembered as Moors. All right? And so, put that in. Here you see a picture of the ancient Phoenicians. And here you can see a dark skin with a fez on his head. This is an ancient Canaanite Phoenician. All right. Just continuing on.
Oh, Brother Hakim.
What was that?
Quick question.
Yes.
I was looking at your Moorish assassins. classic.
The Moorish what?
Moorish Assassins, the lecture you did a good while ago.
All right.
And you were speaking about the connection to the Canaanites' connection to the Amalekites.
Yes.
Could you touch on the Amalekites for the people here quickly?
The Amalekites? Yeah. As a matter of fact, I'm going to get into that. So I'm going to get up to that part. That's the fifth one. All right. So here's this is a very interesting book here, too. Africans and Native Americans, the language of race and the evolution of red black peoples. All right. Now, this was very interesting. Another independent source showing that the so-called Indians on the Eastern Seaboard, Newfoundland or Terra Nova, were Moors, come from a book recommended to me by Brother Shalimar called African and Native Americans by Jack D. Forbes. Forbes shows in the book how many so-called Native American Indians were sold into slavery in Africa and Europe, the exact opposite direction of what we were taught the slave trade went in. These Native Americans or Indians were classified as Negroes and Blacks and Moors in the slave books of Seville, Spain, and elsewhere. So wait a minute. If they say that the slave trade was set up, this triangular trade spread up when they was bringing slaves here because they were short of health care, and they need slaves here, then what is this, you know, about of Indians being brought up on the Eastern Seaboard and sold as slaves on the other side of Atlantic, the opposite direction? Would you think if they were short here, they would use them here? It says here, in this book on page 29, slaves from Terra Nova show up, and that's the Eastern Seaboard, show up in the slave markets of Seville and Valencia very soon after 1500. For example, in Valencia during the period to 1516, we find in 1503, Miguel, Manuel, and he's the Hill, Miguel, Manuel, in 1505, Juan and Pedro, in 1507, Antonio and Juan Marco, and in 1515, Ali, now Melchor. So these are Indians with names like Ali. In 1516 Catalina, they were classified as Negroes. All right? So again, the lie that we've been taught that, you know, all the slaves were brought over from Africa. All right? Was the slave trade from Africa to America a hoax designed to enslave free Moors here under the Fugitive Slave Law Acts and a direct violation of a dozen or so treaties signed with Morocco? That's what it was really dealing with. It was a way to get around the treaties. And it was a way to snatch up three brothers and sisters here, saying that they were escaped slaves under the Fugitive Slave Law Act. And you even have persons here who write petition against the Fugitive Slave Law Act, saying, listen, they snatched up three brothers and sisters from over here, saying that we escaped slaves from Africa, which is a lie. So this is the game that's been played. We put in the covers of all this stuff. We're gonna write this thing because they never thought that we would uncover this. They never thought we would uncover this. And the truth is out there, scattered in all these different books, piece here, piece there. But you gotta be like a detective, you gotta put it all together. So as I was doing this, this was like detective work. When I was going through these libraries, these institutions doing this research, I felt like a detective basically, trying to piece this thing together. All right? Again, about Moore being here, this record's from China, about us being here. All right. There was a report in a magazine, and it refers about Moore's wearing sashes and feathers over here, according to the Chinese annals of Fuchang, about the trips that they made over here, and they said that the natives are entirely black account to people here. They're the so-called Negrito types, the small Twa people types, and they found the taller. We find Moors here as well, which they refer to, you see here. The Chinese said that the natives are entirely black. They talk about the scorched pygmy people, about men who use wooden arrows with iron points, and the mountain of the Eastern Pass was the country of refined gentlemen. Here they talk about the Moors, specifically. These people, the record relates, have clothing, hats to my pheasants, sashes, and swords. They have tigers and panthers, which are gentle and tame. They eat millet, just like in West Africa, and wild beasts, and have numerous variety of birds. All right, this is coming from a direct quote from that particular magazine. Talking about here, the Chinese. All right, again, I found another book called, the name of the book was called The Secret Archives of the Vatican. This was another jewel, and the secret archives of the Vatican have walls, it's underground, the walls 5 feet thick and 24-hour security. Now, what they hide about it? What the Vatican Secret Archives is actually a library of libraries. As they were conquering different walls and different locations, they would seize the library and transport it to the Secret Archives as the so-and-so collection. So they wasn't just burning books. They were taking the originals of these books, put them in the Secret Archives, and burning the copies, any copies that was out there, to make sure nobody get any copies of this stuff. All right, but they wasn't burning the originals. The originals were sitting right there in the Vatican Secret Archives. And one day, you're going to get that information. You're going to get all the information they got hidden in the Smithsonian Institute, as well as the Secret Archives of the Vatican. And then in those two places, our whole history is just sitting up right up in there. All right? It talks about the Queen of Sheba, and now what was interesting, it talks about the Queen of, in that book, Secret Archive, they talk about a document that was found that Columbus actually used to get part of that as well as to finance his voyage in. And it talks about the Queen of Sheba. Hold on, it talks about the Queen of Sheba sailing through the Straits of Gibraltar. Let me see here. The Queen of Sheba has sailed out of the Mediterranean into the Atlantic, and there's 95 degrees to the westward by an easy passage. So it talks about the Queen of Sheba coming up here, and the Queen of Sheba is really, guess who? Queen Hatshepsut. Queen Hatshepsut and the committee is really Queen of Sheba. All right? And when they talk about Queen of Sheba sailing to the Holy Land, they wasn't talking about Somalia, they was talking about Punic or Phoenician America. All right? So that's in here too. We get into that also. All right, continuing on. Here's another article here, and it says, and this is a book called Leo Weiner's book, Africa and the Discovery of America. This is a 3x6 mad jewels in this book, dealing with the whole West Africa-Mexico connection. Maya, all that old man. And it says, on November, now this was curious, in the diary it says, on November 2nd, Columbus decided to send Rodrigo de Zeres and Luis de Torres, who had lived with the Adelantado of Mercia and was a Jew, and knew Hebrew, Chaldaic, and some Arabic, to see the king of Cuba in order to present the letters and find out all that was necessary. Naturally, a man who knew Arabic and another who knew the language of Guinea, West Africa, as you heard before, were especially adapted to hold converse with the kings of the Indies, because they were lost. Speaking Arabic, everything. Speaking the language of West Africa and Cuba. All right, so none of this stuff there is new. All right, and again, going back to the Sunken City, they found off the coast of Cuba, 2,100 feet below sea level. It's all coming from our ancient civilization here. The main of Mexum, which they mystically refer to as Atlantis. All right. Here in another book, like I said at this point, you know, I was at the point here where I was able to walk into a library, blindfolded, pull out books, to talk about more. I found another book called The Negro Trailblazer, and this has something here that just like blew my mind. It says here, and this goes back to Queen Sheba and all stuff like that too. It says, know ye that on the right hand of the Indies, there's an island called California, very near the terrestrial paradise. Now, you know California was named after a Moorish queen named Khalifa. Very near the terrestrial paradise was just people with black women without any men among them, this is what he was saying about the Amazon, because they are accustomed to live after the fashion of the Amazon. They were a strong and hardy body, and of moderate courage and great force. And I was glad to put this in there because this can deal with the Moore system. It says, the island was the strongest in the world from the steep rocks and great cliffs. Their arms were all of gold, and so were the comparison of the wild beasts which they rode after having tamed them, for in all the island there is no other metal but gold. Now you know why they would be gold rush in California. Then you have all these sisters there, you know, everything they have is in gold, all right? They lived in caves very well worked out of rocks with much labor. They had many ships in which they sailed to other climes. Now, you've never heard about this in any history books. They had many ships in which they sailed to other climes to carry on their voyage to obtain booty. The various Christian knights assembled to defend the emperor of Greeks and the city of Constantinople, for Turkey, against the attacks of the Turks and the infidels. And on this occasion, the Queen of California and her court ended this war. Now, we were never told anything in any history books about a queen in California getting involved in the Crusades. That was like totally unheard of. We never heard nothing about that. Again, as I was picking this stuff up, it was like, I had a weird feeling going through my body as I was coming across all this information. I actually asked myself, I said, wait a minute, did this stuff exist before? I said to myself, am I studying history? Or am I actually writing it? And that gets to a whole other thing, which I'll maybe speak about another lecture about that whole thing, because believe it or not, history is not etched in stone like we think it is. History is actually changeable, but that's a whole other thing. We'll talk about that later. That gets into your God-like power, all right? So anyway, here's Sir Francis Bacon. Dell was told about Sir Francis Bacon. He was the head of a secret society, which used the pen name of Shakespeare. This secret society was the original Rosicrucian order, but they used Shakespeare. William Shakespeare was the actor in the little theater. He couldn't even sign his name, so no way he put out all those works. These were those who studied more science. Sir Francis Bacon was studying more science, but they couldn't put it out like that because of the Spanish Inquisition. It would have been burnt at the stake. So they had to put it out secretly under the pen name of Shakespeare. And here you see Sir Francis Bacon. He's what they would call a tawny Moor, a mulatto Moor, all right? And he studied, and King James I actually had him translate the Bible, which we have the so-called King James Version, but they told him that he couldn't sign it. So what he did in the secret society, they would secretly put their name in it under the pen name of Sir Francis Bacon, under the name of Shakespeare. If you go to the Bible and you go to King James Version, you go to Psalm 46 and count 46 words down, you see the word shake, and 46 words up, you see the word spare, Shakespeare. Right in the very center of the Bible, all right? That's not no coincidence, all right? They studied our science. As a matter of fact, King James, his Arabic name of James is Yaqub, all right? The translation of Yaqub, but the English version of Yaqub is James, or vice versa, all right? So anyway, that's a whole other science right there. This is a book called Mystery of the Mexican Pyramid by Peter Tompkins, and it shows all the Moors' heads being cut off and put on stakes. And it says here, designed for detection and punishment of heretics, the Inquisition, which I talked about before, the reason why they use Shakespeare's name, was used as a giant pork barrel for the enrichment of the crown. This is how they made their money. This is how they just took people's money. Enrichment of the crown, church, and inquisitors by cheerfully eliminating dangerous radicals, i.e., those who had been taught medicine, geography, rhetoric, chemistry, physics, mathematics, and astronomy by Moorish philosophers in universities such as Cordova, whose libraries have since been destroyed. So in other words, anybody who was practicing or dealing with Moorish science, all this was considered under Moorish science, medicine, geography, chemistry, physics, If you double that, his English is coming after you. All right? And he used the simple fact that you practice that, they use it as an excuse to kill you and seize your wealth. It's how they made themselves rich. All right? The English was also an excuse to rid the planet of such organized mystics as the Illuminati, Pantheists, Manichaeans, and Albigensians. So here you see the original Illuminati and so on and so forth dealt with more science. And it was all lumped into the same category by the Catholic Church. All right, very important to understand that. All right, just go ahead a little further. Sir Francis Bacon is where I show. Sir Francis Bacon was a master code and cipher. All right, so when they translated the King James into the Bible, they locked it up in the original manuscripts. There was certain codes and cipher lined up in there, but it was lined up like how those crossword puzzles and stuff is, where you have certain words going diagonal, certain words going across, certain words going up and down, and he used to compass a square on top of it because that was useful in terms of delineating the code by placing a compass square on certain way, or going the Bible in certain ways. He was able to come across the code, the ciphers that was embedded in there. All right, here's actually Psalm 46, 46 words down, shit. 46 words up, spit. Now come on, you think that's a coincidence? Psalm 46, 46 words down, 46 words up. All right? So, people reading that, I don't know, some of the Christian one day I was talking about, I said, you think that book, that the book is the word of God, so on and so forth? I said, well, why would God sign his name in the middle of it as Shakespeare? All right? So, that's just food for thought. Anyway, here we have CMA. All right. Here we have Bengay, Benjamin Banneker, who we all refer to as Bengay Emmanuel Ouali. He not only designed Washington, D.C., but also designed the federal government to go with it. That's why they said, in God we trust. God was originally G period, O period, D period. Government, ordinance, Department of Justice, the three branches of the federal government. Government's executive branch, ordinance, the legislative branch, and Department of Justice, judiciary branch. So they were saying this form of government that we gave the Vietnamese high class, they trust.
Can I just ask a quick question? Was that the Hellfire?
Yes.
Was that the Hellfire Club that Sir Francis Bacon was part of?
Say it again, was that what?
Was that the Hellfire Club? I was doing some reading about him or something, and there was some club in England.
Yeah. Well, this stuff with Sir Francis Bacon, he was clubs. These little stuff they were setting up in the caverns and so on and so forth, all this was dealing with secret society. Because remember, like I mentioned before, because of this Inquisition, they couldn't just come out right with this stuff. Certainly, Bacon went to study with them all. And when he came back, he said, man, my people was ignorant. He said, let me put together something. And Sir Francis Bacon is also the originator of the speculative lodge, of speculative masonry. Prior to that, you have operative masonry. These are ones who are physically building cathedrals and churches and stuff like that throughout Europe. That's the operative mason. So Sir Francis Bacon set up the Blue Lodge, the speculative masonry, to build the science using up that operative masonry terminology. That's why in masonry, you got them using the terminology of operative mason in that. All right, so yeah, Sir Francis Bacon was major in terms of a lot of things that took place, you know. And like I said, the whole connection between him and Shakespeare is key. My Rosicrucian just came up to me one day on 125th Street. That's how I was back in those days. On 125th Street, when I was at home selling books, elders used to come up to me, and people used to just come up to me and just give me stuff. But here, on the down low, started here, take this. They seen what I was doing and how I was researching. So he would just come and just give me dope. And one just came one day and just dropped this on me. And it just said, America's oldest secret, the talisman of the United States, the mysterious line of Washington, D.C. And it deals with how in the layout of Washington, D.C. is all these symbols, compass and square, the Morris flag, all these things are all embedded. All the 12 signs of the zodiac is all embedded in Washington, D.C., which is exactly 10 miles by 10 miles square, all right? and is made from a portion of Virginia and a portion of Maryland, and therefore you got the Virgin Mary. Wow. Virginia, Maryland, the Virgin Mary. So a lot of science behind Washington D.C. and what Benjamin Banneker and they put together is like a computer chip, like a clock. You know what I'm saying? Science. You know, you stand on one street and you'll see the sunrise up on the vernal equinox, another one on the solstice. It's like a computer. All right, so that's dealing with Washington D.C., HC, Mercury, right here by the White House. All these signs are laid out in the streets and the layout of it. Then we came across something called the George Washington Masonic Memorial the George Washington Masonic National Memorial Museum in Alexandria, Virginia. All right, and when you go in there, you're gonna see what? You're gonna see a room called the Grotto Room. And above it, you're going to see the words move per, M period, O period, B period, E period, R, E, R. All right, which stands for the Mystic Order of Veiled Prophets of the Enchanted Realm. Mm-hmm. And when you go in there, you see all of our feathers right up in there. And there's even a feather in there with the name Ben Bey. All right, Khalif. All this is in there. All these feathers are encased in our cases, glass cases, and then there's two pillars in there, and on those pillars you got all of our names, including our titles, and Obey on the pillar inside this grotto room. So I said, you know, I gotta find out more about this, right? So I went to the Grand Lodge in New York City on 23rd Street to get more information about the move from. So when I went there, that library, they got a library on, I think it's the 18th floor or something like that, or 17th floor. And I went there and the door was locked, like they got to buzz you in. And they got a stand there where you got to put down the name of your lodge. So that time, I wasn't a member of no Masonic Lodge or nothing like that. I was like, man, I was just, you know, researching. I was like, man, how am I going to get up in there, right? So I put down, where it said lodge, I put down the titles, I mean, just the initials of Race and National Association of the Morse Field, you know, GS, and you know, so on and so forth. And then I went up to the door, and I said, man, I said, right, when I'm ready to buzz in, I'll be asking about lodge, I'm from all this stuff like that, so I just put my hand on my chin, and the door just said, it just buzzed, and I just walked right in. Right, so I go to the desk, and there's an Asiatic woman back there, and I said, I'm trying to find information about the Grotto and move for and all stuff like that. She's looking at me like I'm crazy, like, whatever, right? So a young European that was behind her, he overheard me. He said, oh, yeah, he said, you look for more information about move for a rock? I said, yeah, I got some information on that one. Let me get you this pamphlet on it. You know, just shows how sometimes our own people, you know, will try to hold you back. So anyway, he went and got me the whole pamphlet and everything. And he's like, if you want, I'll photocopy it for you. I said, yeah. So he gives me the pamphlet, right? So guess what I found out what this whole thing was about? See, a lot of these things, the Europeans used as secret ways to teach about the true history where they got this information from. But they'll make it like a fun and recreational type of degree or order or something like that. You know, but really, it's just a real source of where they got it from. So anyway, in that book they gave me was this. Now, doesn't this picture look familiar? When Al Pacheco showed you what the Bay of Algiers, sitting there on the phone saying, put that tricky money down. Here's the Europeans bending down to them. And you see they got patches and tears in their clothes, showing that they were poor. And we were broke. And then the particular ritual was the court of Mokana. So here, look at the name of it, the court. The name of this ritual that they do in the grotto is called the court of Mokana, the Moorish Canaanites, Mokana. All right, and here them bowing down. This is the ritual that they go. All right, so I thought that was very interesting as well. All right, here you see a stele with Hammurabi Bey. Hammurabi, what the elders taught us, his true name was Hammurabi Bey. All right, and it says here, Moors passed the plank. We were the ones who came up with a plan for a new world order. A noble order of law, and the Europeans merely inherited that plan via the Masonic Lodge. All right, so when you hear the phrase New World Order, no one's words are formed, that was originally a plan laid out by the Moors. And you hear European bases speak about it because they got that through the Masonic Lodge. All right? And that's what you see in the United States, look at the dollar bill, is that Novus Ordo Securum, Key Pluribus Unum. I'll mention more about that later, so the time of it now. Woo! Time flies. All right, I might have to do a part two, but let me, I'm going to kind of like fly through a little bit quicker now. A lot of details here. All 13 books, I created a special sale for the Canaanite War, and you get all 13 books for $30. So that's like about less than $3 per book. It was really originally $10 per book. But if you act now, you can get that for that price. And you can get all this information in there. Yeah, you got the Masonic apron here. There's articles about how George Washington was the first president. It was originally a war. John Hanson, and all this was in the newspaper. You know, all the stuff we was talking about, you know, here's that all the presidents before George Washington. All right. Here I even get into about the Beast System, which is the administrative state set up by Franklin D. Roosevelt in his New Deal. They talk about the Beast in the Bible, and you can either buy it or sell. They're talking about the administrative state that was under the New Deal. Regulatory agency, FCC, FDA, where you can either buy or sell unless you got the stamp of approval, license, all the stuff like this from the administrative agency. That's the B system in which you can either buy or sell unless you have this mark or this seal of approval from these administrative agencies. See, you know, and all the alphabet agencies and so on and so forth, and that's the beast. Alright, but the beast is directly proportional to the ignorance of the people. If the people knew and did what was right exact on their own, there would be no need for a beast. You see what I'm saying? But if you don't do what's right exact, you need a beast standing over you to make you do what's right and what's not right. You see what I'm saying? So anyway, that's a whole other thing there. Let me just kind of fly through a little quick. I'm just going to kind of touch on some main things here. I'm going to kind of fly through, because I ultimately want to get to number 13 before I go into sort of my economics. All right, so this is just some more stuff here with the chance. Again, these are tools. All you should have is in your library, you know, for your children, so they can see and know that what daddy or mommy dealing with is true, it's real, it's document, I can back it up. All right, this is book number three. All right, we'll just touch a few points here. Here I get to the whole science of astrology, or astrologics, and what that's all about. I talk about the elements, the four elements, and we get into, I think it's the whole thing here, dealing with the zodiac. What's that dealing with? All right, so. I want to check that out in a couple of things. I'm sure I can do that right now. Talk about the solstice, all that stuff. I put that whole science, how this is more science. All right, I talk about the different ages. You know, like in the Holy Quran, it talks about how, you know, the gate unto one, as the gate to one age closes, the gate to another flies open at the age such a time. That's dealing with the ages. All right, the earth has a 20, because the earth is 23 and a half degree axis. All right, every 25,920 years, it describes a circle. All right, if you take that 25,920 years and divide it by 12 signs of the zodiac, you get 2,160 years per a zodiac sign, and that's called an age of man. All right, and the age of occurrence began right around the time of the birth of the prophet and will last for 2,160 years. That's the age of man. The previous age before that was the age of Pisces, whose key words was I believe. And that deals with Jesus and faith. And that's the reason why they say Jesus does the multitudes with fish and bread. All right? The fish is Pisces. The bread is the opposite sign of Virgo, whose pitcher holding wheat in our hand. All right? Prior to that, you had the age of Aries, which dealt with Moses, which was symbolized by Moses in the Bible. All right, the key words with Gary is I am. That's when Moses was Pharaoh, and Pharaoh said, who's your God? He said, I am that I am has sent me. All right, showing that was the age of Aries. That's the reason why the Jews to this day blow the ram's horn. All right, the prior age, that was the age of Taurus. That's when Moses came out from the mountain and seen him worshiping the golden calf. far as the bull, all right, that was in the, he was still called in the old age teaching. All right, he was in the new age, he was in the age of Aries. All right, he was out of the age of Taurus. This is why you see the bull, these the bull statues in Babylon, and with his half man and half bull and all that stuff like that. And also in ancient Kemet, you see a lot of the bull motif, all right, that was in these different ages. All right. So we get this issue, number three, I got deep into it. All right, we talk about Israel, 12 tribes, 12 zodiac signs, Is, Ra, Il, Is, Isis, the moon, Ra, sun, Il, the stars, nation, the sun, the stars, Israel. All right, so we get that there. You know, a lot of stuff dealing with that. Is from the Quran of Mecca, all right, from a surah called or the roots or the zodiac sign. That said, by the sky, slain the zodiac sign, by the promised day of judgment, by the one that witnessed and the subject of witness, both the makers of the pit or fire. So it's saying by the signs of the zodiac sign, by the promised day, you need that kind of reference. All right? Here, I'm talking about the Holy Quran, circle seven, 7 days of the week, the seven planets of the ancients, going over to Saturn, and what's that dealing with? All right, times a dollar bill. This to that, here you see the one, and here you see spider webs coming out. It's 12 houses there, if you count them. Toes on the zodiac, right there on the dollar bill. All right, so we get to our idea, gematria, you know, the language, number code, used by the Illuminati, Mason, Benjamin Banneker, I guess the whole science of the Fez. Here you see, you say Muhammad, one of the teachers of Marcus Garvey with the Fez on. Here you got Honorable Muhammad with the Fez on. Here you got CFA with the Fez on. Here you got a whole bunch of Phoenicians with the Fez on. Again, Phoenicians with the Fez on, which again is the white pharaoh of Egypt. Here you have the Assyrians with the Fez on, the castle coming down. Here you got Canaanites and Hittites from Cyprus with Fezes on. Here you got Vishnu with the Fez on. Here you got Double Crown, and that's the Fez with the ball on top. All right. Here is another representation of the Fez. And I get to some other things. Here you even have Nazi with Fezes on. And the book that they're reading is Islam and Judaism. Because, of course, as you know, Hitler's studying more science. And here you even have, this is J. Edgar Hoover with the Fez on. All right? With the crescent moon and sword above it. All right? And this goes into the prophecy in the book of Revelation. It said that in the book of Revelation, it said, and there appeared a great wonder in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, because she symbolizes the temple, and the moon under her feet, and upon her head a crown of 12 stars, and she being with child, cried, we got child, travailing to give birth, and pain to be delivered. And there appeared another wonder in heaven, and behold, a great red dragon, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and 7 crowns on his head, and his tail, and next they get from our Jacob Hoover. See and bait towards that. The crescent moon and star is the woman and child, and the sword above that symbolizes the persecution of the woman and child. So here you see him with this on his head, and he put together a program known as what? COINTELPRO, whose stated purpose was what? To stop the rise of a black messiah. So that was the fulfillment of this prophecy of this woman travailing to give birth, talking about the whole movement. She symbolized the movement travailing to give birth to us, a child that will rule the nations with a rod of iron. All right? It said, but the dragon stood forth, and his tail to a third part of heaven, and did cast into the earth, and the dragon stood before the woman, which was ready to be delivered for them, to devour her child as soon as it was born. COINTELPRO. stop the rise of a black Messiah. Right, so it's all there, you know, be nothing spooky about it. This is real life we're talking about here. Alright, so I get into awareness and all that stuff like that. Alright, some other stuff. Alright, so that's number three. I thought this was interesting too. Truth is stranger than fiction. I found a manual, and the name of it is called, it's called the Ku Klux Klan. This is the Ku Klux Klan. Now, here the so-called rednecks in America, what do they know about history? Alright? And check out the list of the Klan officers. Their vice president is called Khalif. Like Khalif. So, I mean, truth is strange. If you get the Ku Klux Klan, and their book is called the Ku Klux Klan. And their vice president is called Khalif. So, I thought that was interesting as well. Alright, so we got all kind of like little jewels like that in here, you know. Stuff that just bugged me out. Now, again, dealing with the Black Coast, Virginia, when he was talking about how, like, for instance, this is from the records of the Court of Assistance in Massachusetts, 1630. And it says, Minkery, the Blackamoor, was admonished and dismissed. Alright? So here you see more in here, and he was dismissed. He was just admonished and dismissed. Alright? And going back here, in the Black Coast, Virginia, it said that all these so considered slaves of a war to family, this is 1600s. So I'm saying, if the Moroccan Treaty of 1787 was 1787, then why are they saying all these shall be considered slaves except for Moors and Turks and amity? And amity means you have an outstanding treaty of peace and friendship, but this is 1600s. So I said, wait a minute, what do you, I said, America declared its independence in 1776. I said, so maybe these were treaties with England prior to that. And sure enough, I found over a dozen treaties between Morocco and England. This is 1756. A piece of Morocco signed and so on and so forth, Treaty of Commerce with so and so, Treaty of Peace with Sidi Mohammed Haider, Morocco, 1666. I found over a dozen treaties. All right, you know, this is Black Coast, Virginia, 1705, before the Moroccan Treaty, 1787. They said, for any, if any Negro or other infidels such as declared slave, i.e. those not Christian in their own native country, except Turks and Moors and amity, shall not withstand and purchase any white servant. So this was even talking about how Moors, this was a law that was passed stopping Moors from buying Christian white so-called slaves. So if the Moors didn't have them a slave, why would he even need to pass a law like this? And this is 1705. And according to the Encyclopedia Britannica, there were more European slaves than Asiatic slaves up until 1776. There were more European slaves. This is doctrine. All right, here's what goes on more treaty of peace with the Bassa and Iban of Algiers. All right, all kinds of treaties here. All right, here's you, more Iban. All right, so I'm going to kind of fast forward. You know, it's hard to fast forward past certain things, you know, without going into it a little bit, but I'm going to kind of fast forward. Again, all you in the books here, if you could get a hold of. Let me go ahead.
Hey, how do you get a hold of them? Would you email you, or how do you get a hold of them?
Oh, on the same page that I have the video that you're looking at on, that same page, I set up with a special price on there for the K&I board. So if you just scroll down to the bottom page, you get all 13 of those for $30, and it's instant download. They're all ebooks, so the minute you pay for it, you get it immediately. You know, you have to pay for snail mail and stuff like that.
Okay.
All right. So here I talk about, I get into the whole Genesis table of nations, that's Abraham, Shem, and all that stuff like that, and what that dealing with. All right, I'm not going to go too much deeper with that now. Here you got Chinese, this is people from China, the original Chinese from the Shang Dynasty, this is how they look. Alright? You still got many of them to this day. They look the same. Alright? So Vaughn had asked, I guess, the whole deal about Nimrod in there, and how Nimrod was the first ruler of a world order, and how the Jews talk about how their Messiah will be just like Nimrod, will be second to Nimrod in terms of being able to rule like that. Here are some more Canaanites, stuff like that. Here, and I love this picture here. This is a picture of a Mohawk chief, obviously a brother. And this painting was made in England when they brought these chiefs to England. And remember, now here, we were taught that we had a chiefdom set up over here. The Europeans referred to it as a chiefdom. And those who were sheiks, they referred to as chiefs. And this is again the game that was played. But here you see this is a Mohawk sheik or chief. And here's another picture here. I have another one too. And look at the thing you hold in his hand, the mace that he's holding in his hand, how it curves up like that. Exactly like the mace that you find in West Africa. Exact same thing in West Africa. All right. The Etruscans, that get them to war, all that stuff, the original habits and stuff. Those places here you see Etruscans, the original habits of Italy. He's a brother with Afro. And he's an original habit for Italy, the Etruscans. He's the other one that both gave with Afro. All right? So I'll get into that. Here you see the original inhabitants of Greece and Minoan. And here you can see, obviously, they were all brown skin with Afros. And these are the original inhabitants, the original Minoan and Mycenaean civilization. So again, was up with it. All dark skin with Afros. All right? Here you see the feds again. And here you see, when you see these concentric coils like this in sculpture, that's symbolized naps, like nappy hair, like naps. That's how they symbolize naps. All right? And here you see, you got the Ankhens there. All right? And here you see with the feds, wall on top, castle coming down. All right? Here you can see the nappy hair, the nappy beard. Right, so all this there again, Greece. This is coming from Greece, the nappy hair. Here's the Buddha. Buddha with the nappy hair. Here's the original, this is the oldest representation of the Israelites. Here's the oldest representation of the Israelites. Here's the Senator seized them and took them captive. And here you see them with the nappy hair and nappy beard. This is the oldest representation of the ancient Hebrews, with the ancient Israelites, and here you see them with nappy hair and nappy beard. All right, so the pictures are worth 1,000 words. Right, so all this is not. This is the fourth book. I know we're having a time to get to 13, but I'm going to try and go a little faster. Here again, you see the Israelite captives. Captives of Judah, nappy hair, nappy beard, all right? And even, as we know in the Bible, the Ancient of Days is a sign with hair like sheep, all right? Hair like wool, like unto sheep, white as snow. So there's only one people I know who have hair like sheep, all right? Woolly hair, all right? That's why the prophet said, don't refer to your hair as pinky, refer to it as woolly. Right, dealing with that whole connection with the sheep. All right, so continuing on, that was issue number 4, this is issue number 5, where I talk about shepherd kings in Egypt, the Hyksos, and how we were taught that the Hyksos were Europeans. They were not. They were actually Moors coming into Egypt after cataclysms to restore order. All right, so I get into that whole thing here, how they were the Amalekites, or Canaanites. And these were the pharaohs. They talk about Amalekite pharaohs that ruled Egypt, those the Hyksos. So really, the Hyksos were Canaanites who were displaced as a result of the cataclysms and went west into Egypt. And when they got there, the reason why the Afrocentric scholars thought that the Hyksos were European was because they thought that they came and destroyed Egypt. But they noticed at that time, temples were destroyed, artwork was destroyed and broken, and they thought that they were some barbaric Europeans who came and destroyed everything. No. But Briscoes were actually more capable Canaanites who were displaced because the cataclysms that took place, like I said, that's recorded in the Bible as the floods of Noah, the destruction of the Tower of Babel, and the things that happened during Exodus, all from the same cataclysm. So when those Canaanites did it into Egypt, Egypt was in a total state of red alert. You know, everything was destroyed not because of the Hyksos, because of the cataclysm, the temples and stuff, everything was broken down. And the Hyksos, the Canaanites, actually restored order in Egypt and ruled as a pharaoh. And it was those same Canaanite pharaohs mentioned in chapter 47 that awarded us the land. Alright? So it says here, the key of civilization was and is in the hands of the Asiatic nation, the Moors, who were the ancient Moabites, and the founders of the city called the city of Mecca. Well, those Moabites who were the founders of the holy city of Mecca was also referred to as the Amalekites. Because it says here, the Amalekites, this is from Ancient and Chaos by Emmanuel Velikovsky, the Amalekites supported the Canaanites. This also explains the reversal in the progress of the Israelite penetration into Canaan and their occasional status as vassals. The Amalekites, and you see the word Malik meaning king, shepherd king, ruled over vast territories and their colonial politics aligned themselves with kindred nations. This is the ground for the Hebrew tradition that the Amalekites posed as Moabites, Canaanites, and other peoples. And in these disguises carried on war against the Israelites. The Midianites, who were close kin of the Amalekites, related since the days when the one people occupied Mecca and the other lived in Medina, together they often invaded the land of Israel just before the harvest. So here you can see that the Amalekites, Malachites, kings, shepherd kings, was also known as Moabites and Canaanites. And they also lived in Mecca. Alright, this goes back to what the prophet said, when he said the Moors, who were the ancient Moabites and the founders of the holy city of Mecca. As a matter of fact, the Amalekites were the founders of the Arabic language. When you go here to the Encyclopedia of Islam and look at the Amalekites, it says founders of the holy city of Mecca. So that right here sums it up. When I see that, I said, alright, boom, here you go. Here the prophet says, he's referring to the Moors, who were the ancient Moabites and the founders of the holy city of Mecca, here in the Islamic Encyclopedia saying that the Amalekites of the Bible, that they were the founders of the holy city of Mecca. And here you see right here where the Amalekites were also often confused with Moabites and Canaanites. So here you see the same people. These are the shepherd kings, the Hyksos, who came and restored order after the cataclysm in Egypt and commit. They didn't destroy the temple. It was destroyed because of the same cataclysm that made them come there in the first place. And they ended up martial law and reestablished order there, and then realigned and reallocated the land to all the displaced people. And that's where we were rewarded or received the names of the next one from these same shepherd king, Canaanite pharaoh. It says here, the Amalekites ruled in Mecca, and from their central position on the Great Peninsula, dominated other Arabian tribes. These are the old ones you see in there. This is all the parts of Arabia Felix, Arabia Petria, Arabia Deserta, alike were within the reach of their goals. And then came the upheaval, when I talk about the cataclysm. The Amalekite conquerors came from Arabia, but apparently they had Hamitic blood in their veins. So here you see Ham, the domains of Ham-Mexum. Abu Feth, an Arab scholar of the 13th century, wrote, Shem, son of Noah, had several sons, among them Lord, to whom were born Pharis, Jordan, Tabith, and Amalek, thus ascribing to these tribes a primeval existence. Alright? And so here, in the Quran of Mecca, they also talk about these Cushite Arabians, so-called Amalekites, Hamites, Canaanites, and is referred to as Tamil. If you read the Quran of Mecca, it talks about these destroyed civilizations of Arabia, all right? Tamil being one of them, all right? and it says here, Tamil, the name of one of those old Arabian peoples who selected the ad, asked with another one mentioned in the Quran that was destroyed, Aram Wibar, who had disappeared sometime before the coming of the prophet. A series of older references not of Arabian origin confirmed the historical existence of the name and people of Tamil. Thus, the inscription of Sargon of the year 1715 mentions the Tamil among the people east and central Arabia subjected by their Syria. All right, so again here, we're talking about the same people. All right, so I thought this was important. Here you see on a picture coming from from Arabia, a picture here with a head that looks just like one of the older heads. And this is from Arabia. All right, dealing with this ancient civilization that ruled Arabia, which was eventually destroyed, and is referred to in the Quran of Mecca as Ad and Tamil. All right, and you see a close-up of their face, which is like one of the Olmec heads. This is from Arabia, showing who built that ancient civilization. All right, so I want to touch on that. Again here, it says here, the tribe of Amalek were descended from Amalek, the son of Eliphaz, the son of Esau. Though some of their Oriental fathers say Amalek was the son of Ham, the son of Noah, and others the son of Ash, the son of Shem. There's a lot of confusion between the line of Shem and his line of Ham, because in reality, the line of Shem is just a branch of Ham. All right, and the reason why you know that is because when you look at the Semitic languages, they're divided up into hundreds of dialects. Where if you look into the Shemitic languages, they may be six or so dialects. Showing that the one that's the more older had more time to break up into more dialects. And Shem is just one branch of Ham. This is why there's a lot of confusion, even in the table of nations, in the names of the Hamites and the Shemites. All right, they're one people. All right, so anyway, continuing on, I just want to touch on that. This is still number five. I got a lot of information, all documented. Now check this out to show you again that these were Canaanite Moors, so-called Histos. Look at the name of the Histos. They have Arabic sound names like El Walid. They go from 15th dynasty, Shalit, Yaqub. You know, there's a pharaoh with the name Shalit and another pharaoh with the name Yaqub. Now, how many Moorish emperors or kings were they named Yaqub? All right, so again, you see this whole connection with Egypt, the capital dominion of the Empire of Mexico. All right? And they had names like that again, Yaqub, Shalit, so on and so forth. And this name, Mabre, sounds Ethiopian. Again, showing the whole Kushite connection as well. All right? The shepherd's crook that you see the pharaohs with, that came in the time of the shepherd kings. All right, the whole shepherd's crook. All right, and that was dealing with the divine kingship that was handed down to the children of Ham. All right, and there's a whole other thing dealing with that shepherd's crook, but that's a whole other lecture right there. All right, the kings of Sumer. All right, I get to all that again. All the stuff, all ancient stuff. Here's the, dealing with a Carthage, all right, and Hanni Ao, the must got the ill, the Ao, Day, the Bay, Ali, all right, Hanni Ao, all right, Hannibal, all right, Hannibal Carthage, ABC, brother, little Afro, all right. The band going around, just like you see the wars and the host of arms, all right? And we get into all that again, all right? Memnon the Great, we'll get into that. Here's the famous Angelo Solomon. He's the one who taught, he was the grandmaster of the lodge that Beethoven and Haydn were all members of. He's the one who brought the whole literary tradition into the Masonic Lodge. With the more, my name is Angelo Solomon, with a turban on and everything. All right? So, again, I thought this was cute here. Here's a brother from Greece. Anyway, he got a kangaroo hat on. I put this on a stain, nothing new under the sun. And look, another brother here with the locks and everything from out of Greece. All of us Greek, out of Greece. All right? I got stuff about continental currency of America, and how that was based on the Moorish currency, the dinar, the dollar. All right? A lot of stuff here. In terms of Jesus or Isa, I came in contact with the Roman wanted poster for them. So naturally, if you have a wanted poster, you know, you want to want to describe the person as accurately as possible so you can apprehend the person. So when the Roman wanted poster, the Roman wanted poster, he described as a man of simple appearance, mature age, dark skin, small stature, 3 cubits high, candy hair, with a parton in the middle of his head, after the manner of the Nazarites, which means he had dread parted in the middle.
Wow.
And with an undeveloped head. So this is from the Roman form, which means a wanted poster that was put up all throughout the Roman Empire, describing Jesus, and he had into dark skin. So if he was white, so-called white skin, as Europeans try to say, or light skin, why would he put dark skin on? They'll be apprehending the wrong person. All right, so I thought that was very important. So this is good for the Christians, you know, let them know, take down that, you know, that Michelangelo's son or whatever nephew picture you got on the wall.
Islam. Hakim. Islam, question. In measurements, the cubits, what is it in feet? What's the equivalent in feet?
I got some information on that. I don't have it in front of me right now.
Okay.
But I think that, you know, I would include that in another lecture, though. But I know you're talking about the translation of the cubit into feet.
Yes.
I don't have that in front of me right at this moment.
Okay, okay.
I'll retrieve that.
Okay, great. Part two.
Yeah. Just talking about the pyramids and mounds of China. He was short, though. I mean, based on that, he was definitely of short stature. He definitely wasn't tall. I mean, he was, you know, very short stature. I mean, he's talking about like maybe about like 5, definitely under 6 feet. He's talking about maybe like 5 feet, something like maybe 5 feet 4 inches, something like that. He was definitely short. I hear talk about the pyramids and mounds of China. This pyramid is a mound in China that's even bigger than the pyramid in Xi'an and Giza. And you see a whole bunch of them right here. And the Chinese government is trying to keep it secret. Now, why would they want to keep it secret? Because they know that these ones built them. And they refer to it as the Shang Dynasty, who the Shao Dynasty described them as being black with oily skin. All right? And these jinn, they also refer to them as jinn, like a genie or jinn. These jinn or men appear to be the jinns or genies of the primitive Arabs and Persians who came in contact with them in East Himalaya and Iran. Famous in Antediluvian history as good and beneficent beings, friends of the Turks or Persians, the ancient Iranians or Persians, jinn huang, meaning human emperors, were 9 brothers, sons of the Ti Huang, who divided the earth among them and built cities with surrounding walls. Alright, so they come out of ancestors and built all these kingdoms and cities all around the world on that pyramid belt. Alright, because that whole pyramid university system surrounds the earth like a belt, and everywhere on that belt you're gonna find pyramids, whether it's China, Mexico, Africa, the pyramid university system. Alright, and this is what that's talking about there. Alright, so anyway, all this is in the fifth issue. Here I got George Washington's letters to Emperor Morocco in his original handwriting form. And in the appendix, I got the actual breakdown of the words. And man, you should see what he says here. Check out what he says. He says, great and magnanimous friend. This is how he addresses King Morocco. And then he says, since the date of the letter of which the late Congress by their president addressed to your premier. So here's George Washington, and he's saying that he's telling you right here that there was a president before him in the Continental Congress. And that there was over 200 letters since back and forth between the Continental Congress and the Morocco. People like their main supporter. The United States addressed to Europe, now think about this a moment. This is George Washington. They declared their independence from the King of England, 1776. But here he's referring to the Morocco, and for Morocco asked, he says, since the date of the letter which the late Congress by their president addressed to your Imperial Majesty. He defines him as Imperial Majesty. The United States of America have proper to change their government and to institute a new one agreeable to the Constitution, of which I have the honor of hearing, including a copy. The time necessary employed in the arduous task and the duration occasioned by so great though peaceful revolution will apologize and account for your majesty not having received those regular advices and marks of attention from the United States, which the friendship and magnanimity of your conduct towards them afforded reason to expect. So here, George Washington actually apologizing to the Emperor Morocco for not sending them the letters that they usually regularly be sending to him. He's apologizing for that. The United States have unanimously appointed me to the supreme executive authority in this nation. Your Majesty's letter of the 17th of August 1788, which by reason of the dissolution of the late government remained unanswered, has been delivered to me. I have also received a letter which your Imperial Majesty, I'm bugging out where he's referring to him throughout here as his, your Imperial Majesty, has been so kindly right in favor of the United States to the far shores of Tunis and Tripoli, and I present to you sincere acknowledgement and thanks of the United States for this important mark of your friendship for them. We greatly regret the hostile disposition of those regions and towards this nation who have never injured them because it was so snatching up European slavery. It's not to be removed in no terms and our power to comply with. Within our territory, there are no mines and
clean.
Now, check this out.
He's
saying within the territory, remember, those 13 colonies and a 13 plantation or 13 charter corporation. So in other words, it's like we own the land, we just let us set up 13 storefronts, basically. And so this is why he's saying, now we know America, there's crazy going on, stuff like all over the place. But he's saying within our territory, there are no mines either of gold or silver in this young nation, just recovering from the waste and dissolution of the long war, have not as yet had time to acquire riches by agriculture and commerce. But our soil is bountiful and our people industrious, and we have reason to flatter ourselves that we shall gradually be useful to our friends. The encouragement which your majesty has been pleased generously to give our commerce with your dominions, the punctuality gave a most favored nation trading status. The punctuality with which you have caused the treaty with us to be observed, and remember, the Moroccan Treaty of 1787 is not a treaty between the two equal powers. All the scholars that study treaties will tell you that. It's more of a treaty from a superior power granting certain rights and privileges to an inferior power, in this case, United States. All right, so it's not a treaty between two equal powers. And you can see just by the language and how he's talking here that it's not that. All right. So he said, the punch line which you have called the treaty with us to be observed and the just and generous measures taken in the case of Captain Proctor make a deep impression on the United States and confirm their respect and attachment to your Imperial Majesty. I mean, it's all right here in George Washington's own handwriting, the nature of the relationship here. They give me pleasure, he's saying that they're attached to the Moorish Empire and his Imperial Majesty. It gives me pleasure to have the opportunity of assuring, and that's why, and I was one of the first ones, maybe still the only one who's saying this, is that the mandate, when they talk about the mandate and the prophet and dealing with Cuba, the mandate is the Moroccan Treaty of 1787, in force for 50 years. That's the mandate. Continuing on, I'm telling you, you're going to hear more talking about that coming soon, but don't hear too many more talking about the mandate is the Moroccan Treaty. It gives me pleasure to have this opportunity of assuring your majesty that while I remain at the head of this nation, I shall not cease to promote every record that may conduce the friendship and harmony, which so happens to stand between your empire, didn't say your nation, your kingdom. He said your empire in them. And shall esteem myself happy in every occasion of convincing your majesty of the high sense, which in common with the whole nation, I entertain the magnanimity, wisdom, and benevolence of your majesty. All right? So he's talking about how he goes to everything in his power to maintain friendship. Naturally, you can't turn around and enslave the citizens and inhabitants, the people of that same empire that you're saying all this about. So that's why they had to get you out your proper name, snatch you from your parents, raise you up and tell you that you were Negro, descendant of Africans they brought in West Africa. Once you believe that now, you have taken yourself out of the category of more, and they can do anything they want to do with you. As long as you refer to yourself as more, then you couldn't enslave them, they couldn't do anything to you. Remember the Dred Scott case, the same court that told Dred Scott, the federal government said, Dred Scott, we can't do nothing for you, man. Because in your own deposition, you said that you were Negro, descendant of West African blacks. In your own deposition, you put yourself in the category of chattel property with no rights of white person out of respect. But at the same time, there was another brother who was a Moor, who when they found out he was a Moor and they had strained them, the president himself personally got involved to make sure that brother was free and said, we'll take you, we'll do whatever you want us to do. Now here's two brothers, look the same, basically, but treated two different ways. Why? Because one recognizes nationality as being whore, thereby had to go to his treaty, and one, by his own deposition, put himself in a property of chattel property with no rights of white person by respect. That's the difference. At that time, it was still evident. Later on, everything got fudged up, and even the Europeans lost the true signs of what this is really all about. They brainwashed themselves in order to brainwash us. So, okay, but at this time, it was clear the relationship between the United and the Moorish Empire and how we had to be treated. That's why my ancestors was not enslaved, because they, again, their last name was Moors. They were Moors, and they were listed in the Census Bureau as free inhabitants. And when they instituted slavery south of the Mason-Dixon line, south of the border dealing with Maryland, my ancestors picked up in the early 1800s and went north into New Jersey and purchased farmland there in order to stay north of the Mason-Dixon line and preserve their freedom, because they seen what was happening south of the Mason-Dixon line and how they were snatching up free brothers and sisters under the Fugitive Slave Law Act, saying that they are space slaves that they bought in Africa. This was the game. All right, so continue on. Just finish reading this letter because it just says so much in here. These are documents. See, you know, we're not just making this stuff up. We're not just pulling stuff out of our hat. You know what I'm saying? I'm showing you actual documents. Y'all can go to any library, any institute, and you can find these things there. All right, continue on. It says, it gives me pleasure to have this opportunity for showing your majesty that while I remain at the head of this nation, I shall not cease to promote every measure that may conduce to the friendship with us. How about that part? May the Almighty bless your Imperial Highness, our great and magnanimous friend, with his constant guidance and protection, George Washington. All right, so that's all there for y'all, you know, the whole thing. Here in the appendix, I also put the, this is coming from the General Assembly of Pennsylvania, filed in the House of Representatives, December 75, April 17, 1933. So this is the same time when the Beast system, the administrative state, was being set up by FDR, the New Deal. And it says, Morse American Society of Philadelphia, and use of their names. Back in the days, us Morse, we used this document mainly to show the government that, you know, this ain't some newfangled thing that we just invented. That we as Morse Americans were recognized going back into 1933. It says, many Southern boys of that powerhouse and race, inspired architecture in North Africa and Caribbean with Spain, the influence of artistic government, have become citizens of this nation. All right, in the city of Philadelphia, there is a Morse American Society, or home. All right, and it says, resolved that this house commends the Morse American Society of Philadelphia for the efficient service it has restored has rendered the nation in bringing up about a speedy and thorough Americanization of these former wars, and that in accordance with the fullest right of religion and independence guaranteed every citizen, we also recognize the right of these people to affix the names Ill, or Ali, or Bay, or any other pre-physical surface that they have created for, accustomed to use, so this is so about our religious right. We have the name to the right to use these things, but we use this when we were changing our names and now our titles back in the day. All right, so that was number five. There's a lot of stuff in number five. Number five, I kind of like went off, but that was just number five. All right, you know, we got number six, and I'm just gonna brush through. There's a lot of stuff in here, number six. So this gives us a deep into the whole connection between the remainder of Mexico in terms of both sides of the Atlantic, in terms of West Africa, and in terms of Mexico, and that whole connection there. I have a picture of Costa Guado. I have a picture of Costa Guado with Fez on. Oh, and I think the whole thing about DNA. The whole thing about DNA coding there. Each mind can get in with that. Right, this is who we can plant. And, yeah. Oh, I think that's just what I got to do. This is fucking wild. All right, here I got some more. These are some new old heads and things I found. This is new one I put in my look. Not too many people seen this. All right, this old man. All right, so it's obvious what that's about. And that is, here again, Olmec, strong feature. All right, Olmec. All right, just the further connection to people. And this was found inside of a church down in somewhere in South America, somewhere Olmec did, that was found decorated into an actual church in South America. All right, so that was number six, book six. Then book seven. Number seven. This here is a Moor, and this is from somewhere in Germany. All right, and here you can see obviously that this is a Moor. This is who was on vacation there. She went to one of the town squares and took this picture from her. All right, and this is one of the to see one of the three Magi who came up bearing gifts. You see with the scimitar sword. All right, I just love that picture. All right, so here again, it's the whole connection with West Africa, trust, how our kingdoms were set up, divine kingship, how all that was organized. And here's a picture of Costa Guado, straight up brother with a fez on. And here you see with what? The shepherd's crook. All right, so all our connections dealing with that. I draw a whole bunch of different connections between here's the God Wild design you find in Mexico and you find in West Africa. All right, I just go over a whole bunch of different connections between there, the Sufi teachings, everything dealing with Mexico and West Africa. Here, get to the famous Diwan, the famous samurai of the Moorish Empire. These brothers with no joke. I mean, you know, matter of fact, I was talking to Wesley Snipes about making a movie about this, because for the longest I wanted to get Wesley Snipes into a movie on this, and that's probably one of the reasons why they moved on him like that. Before that happened, I ran to Wesley, because Wesley provided books for me when I was on 125th Street in Harlem. And so I ran into him in Manhattan one day, and I had some videos and stuff for him and everything, and he already had a lot of my stuff, but I was telling him he was just finishing up Blade 3 at the time, and I was telling him about the wars. You know, the D-Wan, the Moorish military, he was like, what? He was like, tell me more, right? So I started breaking down more, talking about the Moorish D-Wan. He's like, you look at me and other brother, he said, it's not like a movie to me. Me and the other brother almost fell out, man, because that was the whole reason why I want to talk to him. I didn't even have to say it to him. He told us. It sounded like a movie to him. So I was like, wow, so this will be a beautiful thing. I want him to get into a movie about the D-Wan. These kids were like the Moor samurai. They was no kind of joke. They had what they called the big broad scimitar sword. They said, well, they could cut a horse in half with one swipe.
Come on.
I'm telling you, they had a lance. They called it the ponderous lance. They said that when they held this lance locked in their feet, it would go through the horse and the horseman. We need to do some movies. I mean, all of us do this little martial art movies and those samurai movies. Shoot, wait till we come up with the Morris D-Man movie. They're going to take it to a whole other level. They was no joke. He said, let me read you one of the quotes. He says, the Negroes at present, they're not the D-Man. Are the grand cavaliers of this part of Barbary. To these, the emperor entrusts his riches, his person, and his women. He's an hereditary, you have to be brothers. The power of these people were at first introduced by the late Emperor Mulai Ismail, whose mother was a Negro, and he himself coming out of the South from West Africa could not trust his lords and subjects. Talk about how he put together, because he wanted to wonder why he was. Mulai Ismail wanted to know what made one of the previous emperors so powerful, so great, and come to find out was because he had an army that was pure brothers, hereditary. So he said, what? He said, let me do the same thing. And that's when he fled these brothers. These soldiers were raised from birth to be soldiers. He said, and he wanted to be pure brothers. You know, that time he had a mixture of all kinds of different people, you know, so-called Arabs, really just mulattoes, it's mulatto race, mixture of Moorish men and European women, not the other way around. He said, collecting all the black brothers and men and then importing them to Sudan, these fighters established great camps wherein they increased and multiplied under the direct supervision. It was simply by the aid of this standing army, with no local sympathy, and all to gain from their master's success that Mulai Ismail held his own and even more so for so long. After Mulai Ismail's death, at which time they were said to number 100,000, they set up and pulled down kings from the rulers of Morocco according to the pay received. And had they found a leader of their own, they would have surely established a dynasty. But it was talking about how much power about that. I got enough information dealing with the Moorish Empire to do movies for days.
Sidi Muhammad, who signed a treaty, they proclaimed him
in Morocco. The D-Man. Well, he refused initially until his father died in 1757. In 1757, Sidi Muhammad became the Sultan. His first step was to scatter the Houthis and garrison Fez with the blacks. He refortified the city and the 12,000 volume library of his grandfather, Mullah Ismail. So here's Mullah Ismail, who we describe as being straight up brother. This, I mean, being straight up black skin, that's how they described him. And that was Sidi Muhammad, who still found Moroccan King. That was his grandfather. All right? And I even published one of the first pictures of Sidi Muhammad. I think that was picture number 13. All right? So I got a picture of that, too. I finally got a picture of him. All right? This dude with the Moorish architecture found in New York City, all that stuff like that. All right? And you know what was deep? I went to this synagogue. It was a synagogue built with Moorish architecture right in the center of Manhattan. In the middle of all these tall buildings is the Moorish synagogue. So I go in there with a video camera, videotaping. I want to document this, right? I say, I can tell people, we got to document this stuff before the story. Do you know, like a month or so later, I'm coming up and I'm driving on the highway, and they're talking about the mosque, the synagogue is on fire, burning. You know, so that's why I said, when we coming up, we got to document it, because as fast as we were getting all these books and stuff like that, they were destroying them. You know, so document this stuff. This is a very important tool, you know, the relationship between us and Morocco. I'm sure y'all probably came across this. This is from 1986, where it says, this is the emperor from Morocco saying that, I mean, ambassador from Morocco saying, it's a privilege for me and for other staff members of the embassy of Morocco to attend this, the Noble Jouali's Centennial Tribute Dinner. Please let me make this opportunity to express to you our collective appreciation of your kind invitation and my personal appreciation for having been chosen to receive Ambassador of the Faith Award. I am greatly honored as those here tonight to be taking part. So let's enjoy the celebration. We don't hear a lot about this, but, you know, we are happy to bring you the outreach from this king, this Majesty King Hassan II, in the people of Morocco. This is who they were telling me to write to, again, with the Journal of Moorish Paradise. They told me to send copies to King Hassan II, who had passed a little while afterwards. All right, but his son, who's in power now, actually went to school with one of the Moorish brothers. So we got a direct connection right there. So that when it comes time for us to start doing movies, I want to go get actual artifacts and things coming from the D-Way. All right, but that's a whole other story. He says, by now, I have been made well aware of your devotion to strengthen the tie linking the Moorish American community to Morocco. Morocco, for its part, welcomes your interest in your work for a better understanding between us. I would like you to know your efforts have not gone unnoticed. Michael Moore's here. Your initiative is to be both respected and encouraged. As to us, we in turn have every intention of doing all possible to make our relationship a vibrant and special one. See, and we need to use this letter to hold them to this. Now, I'm going to skip all this and get down here. He says, but for that goal, let me read it. For that goal to be met, we must also look to the future. We cannot limit ourselves to considering just the historical aspect of our relationship, thereby believing that good relations between us are a matter of faith. Rather, we should understand our cooperation to be a living entity, able to grow and open to the future. Open the future. It is here that we can begin to recognize the importance of our children's role. Whatever advances we make, it is our children who have to follow who have got to hold me to them. And check it out what he says here. Morocco is awaiting your proposals. Mm-hmm. All right? So we need to hold on to this. We need to stop getting our hold, but we need to get ourselves together first. All right? So that's just that. You see that. 7:10. I'm going to have to wind it up soon. Wow. Brother, we're going to have to make another. We're definitely going to have another day.
For sure, for sure.
We will.
Now,
huh? We will, we will.
We got to. Let me. I'm gonna skip something real quick. I'm gonna skip all these issues in between, and I'm just gonna especially recommend everybody read Exodus number 13. 13 deals specifically with the prophet and what he did that makes a nation within the nation. And I saved this for last because I had to learn everything first, and took all that time for me to really learn about everything about the prophet that I needed to know. And that's why I call this number 13, the Master Shemino and the chief letter.
Brother Hakeem, just to put something on the record. This master issue that you put out is one of the most precise and easy to understand booklets about Nobu Juwali and his connection to us and what he brought us without any confusion and without any us having to interpret things or whatever. It's so basic and so simple to understand. I just wanted to put that out there so you know that you did a good number on this one.
Thank you, and I appreciate it. I really went on my way for that because I know it's a delicate issue, and there's so many people come from different angles that I said I got to put out in a certain way. That's why I waited. The issue of really going on the prophet because I didn't really feel that I was fully qualified earlier on.
Right.
The early issues. And so once I do the prophet, I actually really made myself qualified. And the prophet came to me two times in dreams. And, sort of just like confirmed for me. The first time I seen him, my car broke down. I was driving, most of my car, just the electricity, everything just cut off. I just barely managed to literally roll off the highway ramp right into a gas station. And I called for a tow truck, and they said, listen, that's the gas station we're going to tow you to. You might as well just stay there and just, get a hotel room overnight and then have them fix your car in the morning. So I go over to a hotel, and then that night in that hotel, I have a dream, and in the dream I'm in a room, and there's a door in the room. The door is set in the wall, almost like a window. It's not flush to the ground. It's like about a foot or 2 feet off the ground. And it's almost like a window, but it's actually a door. And so I said, that's weird. So I go stand in front of the door, and I feel this energy. Something just told me, open the door. And when I opened the door, the prophet was standing right there. And it's like, shocked me. I couldn't believe it, right? And I'm just feeling this energy coming off the prophet, like almost like a microwave. I'm feeling this energy coming off the prophet, and I smelled the perfume, like a scent. And the scent was almost as if you took the soul of all of our people and wound it all up into one smell, into one scent. That's the scent that I smelled coming from the prophet. And I stood there, and he was just smiling. The prophet was smiling. He was beaming. But he didn't say a word. I didn't say a word because I remember one of the sayings said that. He said, if you see me in a dream and I don't say nothing to you first, don't say anything unless I say nothing to you first or something along those lines. So I didn't say nothing. He looked. And he was just getting smiling. I just looked it. And then I just woke up. And man, that dream had like a special effect on me because I made people so good to see the prophet smiling. I didn't see too many pictures where the prophet was smiling like that. So that made me really feel good. This is right about the time when I wrote this. And at that time, the prophet just revealed to me so much about what he set up, how he set it up, and why he set up the way he did. And I put it all in this particular journal here. All right. And it gets to the prophecy that our ancestors had when we were conquered and Spain and different parts of the world and how they would get a prophecy about when we would come. And it shows how it was a magazine and it said the same thing. Right in 1917, before the prophet started doing what he was really doing in terms of the Most High Temple of America, it says the Negroes fired for the Muhammad to come forth and give him the Quran. Economic and intellectual welfare. Weird. This is from the Champion magazine in 1970. And he prayed for Muhammad to come and give him the Quran. So I was like, wow. Probably came filled with prophecy. And I speak about it here. I speak about what he set up and why he put about the connection with the UNIA, Arnold J. Ford, and how he will be hymns for the UNIA. And how he talked about it here. There was one piece from UNIA where it says in there, Father of all creation, Allah omnipotent, supreme. supreme over every nation. God bless our past president, talking about Martha Garvey. Everybody goes into support of Christianity. You hear, oh, and people pose the phrase, one God, one name, one destiny, in terms of Christ, but they don't tell you what the whole phrase says. The whole phrase really says, one God, one name, destiny. They said, may our rights proclaim in that most sacred name, Allah. That was the full thing. So the full piece says, may our rights proclaim in the most sacred name, Allah, one God, one aim, one destiny. I was like, wow, I mean, that's direct connection right there between the prophet and the UNI. You know, so anyway, I get to that there. Then I get into the prophecy deal with the Mahdi and about the sun rising from the place of the set in the west. And I get to that whole prophecy. So I talk about the prophecy first, and I show how Prophet Nozali came to fulfill that. And they even talk about the prophecies how the Orthodox Islam was going to be against them. It says here, when Anabi was appointed, people worshiped stones and wood, from Muhammad. However, when our Fa'in, the one to come, arises, people will interpret the words of Allah against his interpretation and will argue with him and dispute him by means of the Quran. By Allah, the justice of the Qa'in will enter inside their homes just as the heat and cold enter them. And it talks about here how they had actually passed a fatiha against Prophet Muhammad. I mean, against Prophet Nozali in Egypt. All right, and so it mentioned that would happen, how they would actually use the orders of Allah and the Quran to argue against them. All right, so all the stuff was being fulfilled, left and right, you know, and the prophet comes and then he sets up a divine national movement for the upliftment of a nation. And then I get into what that was about and how the Holy Quran of Morsan Quran, which is one aspect of a much larger movement. I get to our authority, I get to the affidavit, where that came from, how it came from the RCA Act, the Religious Corporation Act of Illinois, and Religious Corporation Act, and what that dealt with, everything. I seen the next time the prophet came, revealed up to me was, I seen a dark, dank basement. And that dark, dank basement, I seen the corner of that basement, this document. And how it was sitting there in the corner, like almost forgotten. And that's, when I woke up from that dream, I sweated so much that my whole pajamas, everything was soaking wet. I could have wrung it out like a rag. And it was right after that dream when I found out everything about the prophet. That's what the prophet's telling me to look into the document deeper. I pulled it out, and everything came forth. You know, about the RCA, and what that all deals with, and how he was set up to find government, and how he even goes back to the original seal of the United States. The prophet said he just thought on he got two seals, and divine and national. All right, and the prophet said, get yourself together on your divine side first. Like it's in the Bible, seek ye the kingdom of heaven, and then all this shall be added unto you from the national side. All right, and when you look, the first seal that they were going to use on the money actually had a picture of Moses. I can use the black law, I can use everything in there. All the laws, all that's what the prophet set up. Here you see in that seal, circle 7, if you take that seal kind of upside down, you see circle 7. Right here on the dollar bill. Alright? All right there. And then I get it to, you know, everything that the prophet set up to get us straight under our own fine victory. You know, so that's all there, and you can all check that out. All right? So that was dealing with that part. The last thing I wanted to just mention, right, and I just want to mention this to all the brothers, is that we have to get our economic house in order. I just want to read this from the prophet, and I'll go deep into it later, but I just want to give y'all a shout out what they're dealing with. The prophet said, right, this comes from the Morris Leaders Struggle Message for America, right? And he says here, in promotion of plans for the betterment of mankind, Here you go. He said, in connection with our religious aims and beliefs, we must promote economic security. The preaching of economic security among us is by no means as widespread and intensive as the circumstances demand. No other one thing is more needed among us at this time than greater economic power. The proper saying back then is even more important right now. Better positions for our men and women, more business employment for our boys and girls, and bigger incomes will follow our economic security. We shall be secure in nothing until we have economic power. A beggar people cannot develop the highest in them, nor can they attain to a genuine enjoyment of the spirituality of the life, because if you just constantly worry about how you're gonna pay rent, how you're gonna buy from week to week, month to month, you ain't got time to be thinking about higher self things. All right? He says here, our men and women and children should be taught to believe in the capacity of our people to succeed in business in spite of the trials and perils phase of some of them. Trials and phase and business are by no means confined to one any particular group of people. In other words, we don't have a monopoly on business failure. It happens to everybody. Some business ventures of all people fail. We have many men and women among our people who are qualified both by training and experience, who are shining light in the business world of all people. It is a sad weakness in us as a people that we have repelled the very encouragement, support, and patronage that would have made some of our worthy business ventures a grand success, and worst of all, have joined the condemnation of them when they fail. Except in cases of actual dishonesty, courtesy, lack of service, and actual unreliability about our business enterprises, and every field of endeavor should have our fullest confidence, cooperation, and patronage whenever and wherever they can be given. And I want to be here. He says here, the problems of life are largely social and economic. In a profound sense, they are moral and spiritual. All right, so we got to deal with the basics. Our social and economic uplift. All right. So in conjunction with that, I have put together something, and this is a new paradigm dealing with business. And I want to see us as Moors really take the forefront of this. What I've actually put together, and I don't have time to go into the details of how it came about and all that like that. I actually have put together an actual virtual world. And what I'm getting ready to do right now, just to close out this presentation, is I'm actually going to bring y'all inside this virtual world and just give you an idea of what we have going on inside this. All right, so just bear with me for a minute. I'm going to log in, and I'm going to give y'all a brief tour, because I want y'all to see the economic potential of this. All right, so let me just make this full screen, and I'm gonna let y'all see a little something. All right, full screen. Here I go. I'm about to log in. The name of this virtual world I created is called Matrix 5, and it was actually launched on December 21st, 2012.
Wow.
All right, because as quiet as it's yep, what was that?
I said, wow.
As quiet? Yes, Matrix 5. As quiet as kept, on that day, you see me with my black feathers on. On that day, December 21st, 2012, at exactly 11:11, one world ended that day. Quiet as kept, as many people know and you're realizing, and a new world began on that day, right in conjunction with our only ancestors' prophecy. Yeah. All right? The world up to that time, on as Matrix 4 ended, and Matrix 5 began. And I would like to talk deeper about that in another lecture. But if you would like to get a synopsis of what that's all about, go to the website secretofsecrets.info. That's secretofsecrets.info. And there you will see a radio show that I did when I launched on KTL Notables Radio. Listen to that radio show. It's about 3 hours long, a little 3 hours long. And it will give you a complete overview of what this is dealing with.
Is that PM or?
This is me.
Is that 11 AM or PM?
Hey, say it. No, Secret of Secrets.info is the link that you go to, and then you'll see the radio show I did on there.
You mentioned that it was 11:11. You mentioned it was 11:11, a.m. or p.m.?
Oh, 11 p.m. And on 11:11 p.m., that's when the ancestor came to me about 2 weeks before this and told me, they said, Akeem, whether you realize it or not, this world that you're creating is tied in with that old, like, prophecy. And they told me at that time that I had to launch this Matrix 5 on December 21st, 2012, at exactly 11:11 p.m., which I did. And man, y'all don't know what I went through to do that. I mean, I went through so much to do that, but I actually launched it on that day on KTL Radio, a little less radio, on Block Talk Radio. I actually launched it on over the air at exactly 11:11 p.m. on December 21st, 2012. It's there, documented everything. Here you see me, I'm in one of my houses in Matrix 5. This is one of the homes that I have inside Matrix 5. I actually put, you see all these chairs in there, I actually put inside the home a 30-seat class inside there. Here you see me, I'm going to zoom in a little bit so you can see a little better. I have a cape on, I have my fez on, so on and so forth. Here's the other side of me, and it's moving a little slow because I have a lot of different, let me close out the other window real quick. I have a lot of windows and stuff going on right now, so it's taking up a lot of memory right now. All right, so here's your screen and back of me here. What I'm going to do is, in this world, we actually have the ability to fly. So let me see if I could fly out here real quick. Let me go back down. So I want to show you, inside this virtual world, I have actual four shopping malls set up. I have movie theaters set up, learning centers for classrooms set up, all kinds of things. Here I'm walking outside of my house, all right? So here you see I'm walking, and it may be a slight delay for those who are looking at the video. I'm walking here, and this is Matrix 5. Let me fly real quick. And Matrix 5, we could not only walk, we could fly, and we could also teleport from one part of Matrix 5 to another part instantaneously. All right, I'm going to fly real quick. I'm going to go up higher, I guess, so you'll have to give you a little bird's eye view of what Matrix 5 looks like. Some parts of it here. We got beautiful homes. We got some homes here with pyramids on top. Some of the members put macabres on top for their homes, sphinx. All kinds of things going on inside here. But I'm going to go over here to the first shopping mall. We have four malls inside here with stores, everything, a movie theater building. Here you see right here, I'm looking down right here. This is a movie theater building right here, M5 Cinema. I have, inside this building, I have six movie theaters in here. So anybody who's into photography, I mean, videography, independent videos, movie making, you can feature your stuff right in here. And we can set this up so that people pay at the door. All right? I'm gonna fly down here and show y'all one of the stores we got set up. All these stores can transact e-commerce. We have our own currency in here called M5, which transfers into real actual money. All right, so this is not, we're not playing commerce in here. We transact in actual commerce. All right? This store right here is an eco store that I put inside here, all right? And here you see the actual store. Now this is gonna change the whole nature of e-commerce. This year is gonna be the beginning of the 3D web, 3D internet, all right? Now up to now, you know, you go to a website and you go through your shopping cart process and everything's on a black page, shopping cart, stuff like that, you can check out, so on and so forth. But now, in the virtual world, you can actually enter into the store and you can see other people shopping in there. You can stop and talk to them. You can exchange phone numbers. You can exchange business cards with them. Let's say I'm the store owner of the store. I could be here in the store, and when somebody comes in, I can walk up to them and be like, how you doing? Come check out the latest stuff we have here. All right? So here's ebooks on displays here, and if I want to order one of them, all I gotta do is press it, press the actual image, hit up here, go to page, and it's actually gonna take me to a page that has the whole shopping cart and everything where I actually purchased this book for instant download. All right, so just to show you, you see popping up on my right. I think y'all might have a little delay. Is the actual shopping cart and everything associated with that store. So when I just press add the cart, I can add more stuff to the cart. I go to another store and add stuff to it from another store to my shopping cart. And after I finish shopping all throughout the mall, I can pay for everything all in one, you know, transaction. All right, so this is gonna change the whole nature of how we do businesses. And I'm looking to do joint ventures. So I'm looking for you all to contact me. I'm scheduling, I'm gonna be doing a, coming up this month on the 22nd and 23rd, I'm doing a business networking meeting inside Matrix 5. So we be having meetings in there. You can do PowerPoint presentations, everything. And so what I'm doing, I want y'all, all you who got businesses or looking to do business, to come inside here. We're gonna network with one another first. And then we're gonna allow each other to do presentations on our different businesses. And then from there, I'm doing joint ventures where we could open up a store for you inside Matrix 5 as a joint venture, which means no money out your pocket. So there's no risk for you. And then we're just gonna divide up the profit. Simple as that. So if you got a business, a viable business, come inside, let me know what's up. It could be joint ventures. You know, we got 48 stores. So first 48, you know, that get with us, we're gonna be going to store here, the Moringa store. I put deal with Moringa product in here, and you actually walk inside the store. And inside the store, I got a stage up here. And on this stage, I actually have a webinar. You can go walk up on the stage, walk up here, get chills up here. You can take a seat. Watch me, I'm gonna take a seat real quick. You can take a seat. All right, just press on each chair. Once you press the chair, you'll be sitting in that chair, you'll be sitting there. And then you press the screen. All right, press it twice. The screen comes front and center. And when the screen comes up, you can sit down here and you can watch a whole webinar. Let's say you didn't know what Moringa was about. You know, when you come to the store, you can just come right up here on the stage and you can actually view a whole webinar just dealing with Moringa. All right, so certain stores, you know, we can put these screens things in the store talking about your product and explaining what the product is about. All right. I'm trying to load up now, but I'm gonna get off of it right now. The reason why is because I'm doing a lot of video streaming right now, and I'm using up a lot of resources right now. So I'm not gonna do that right this second. But let me show y'all something else coming out here. I brought Van Bottom from the Blue Nation. I brought him inside here. He loved it. Before I knew it, Van Bottom was flying all around, all over the place. I'm like, all right, Bam, I don't want to hold you up. I know you got things. He's like, no. He's like, I'm loving it. Bam was loving it because I wanted to get the hip-hop museum in there. He was giving them a hard time putting the hip-hop museum in the box. I said, well, look, in the meantime, let's look over virtual hip-hop museum right here and make it fine. We can charge for entry, you know, all that stuff like that. People can come in and, you know, and get right in. All right, so I'm coming right out right here. This part of the mall is sort of like a central plaza, and so you can just see some of the businesses we have in here. These are different businesses being set up by different members. Punk Design, here's a brother from England who does hats. All right, we're going to put all kinds of stuff in here. Now, what I'm going to do real quick, I'm just hoping this will work while I have it on here. I'm just going to teleport to a couple places real quick. I'm not going to try and walk or fly there right now, because right now, of a great deal of resources, so it may not work properly. All right, so here, you can teleport. Once you have the landmark for a particular area, artists, like for instance, let me suggest some inside the movie theater real quick. All right? So I showed you an outside the movie theater. Like I said, anybody who got videography, video lectures or whatever, we could put those things in the movie theater and we could charge admission right at the door where people pay to get admission. So I'm going to teleport real quick inside the movie theater. All right, so here I'm inside one of the movie theaters right here. And let me step outside for a minute. You can see we have a little lobby, and just like real movie. And I'm telling y'all, once y'all get used to this bugged out this thing, because it's so real that we had to come up with a thing amongst ourselves that we could tell the difference. Oh, what do you call it? So that we could tell the difference between this world and our world. We call it in world. And stuff that when we talk about our world, we call it our world, so people know the difference. You know, because sometimes when you deal with this, you're like, wait, are you talking in world or are you talking our world? You know, which world you talking about? Because it's so similar. All right, let me go. I'm working on this movie theater here. This is the movie theater that's already complete. Look at the one that's already complete. Let me go. They have six different movies in there right now. All the movies that they're in right now is free. Right now I'm in the main lobby. So you see here the main lobby. I got the names of the different things that's playing in here. So there's different things in here now playing. And there's three movies upstairs and three movies downstairs. All right, you just go in there, sit down. Something might just come in here. It might be late at night, 1 o'clock in the morning. I just sit down and look at a movie. You know, once you have an account, you can do stuff like that. All right, so now let me take y'all over here. We have a meditation room. The thing about this meditation room is it's actually in the clouds. This meditation room is actually high up in the clouds. The only way you can access this meditation room is by flying there. So either by flying there or teleporting there. All right, so let me take a look at the meditation room in the clouds. We do 8 meditations a day. So you can come up here anytime, even when there's not a live meditation going on, and you can just sit up there and meditate. All right, so let me take out this meditation room that's up in the clouds. We have some things that we got going on in here. So I want to get the Moors involved. You know, y'all get involved because I'm telling you, when people who are actually find out about this, they all want to be hopping on it. You know what I'm saying? So I'm trying to get a foothold in here first. All right? We have another platform called Second Light. They have over 17 million members. All right? So here, I'm in a meditation room. This meditation room is actually hundreds of feet up in the clouds, and I made it so that it's like nighttime. It's like so you can see the stars. You can see the stars up here. You turn around, you probably can see the moon. You see the moon is out. I made the ceiling transparent so you can see. Look at the moon right there. See the moon. All right. And what time is it? All right. There's no meditation. The last meditation was 6. The next meditation is gonna be at 9 o'clock. And they just press one of these steel walls right here, and then they sit down in a lotus position. And you see I'm sitting down here, and we'll do some kind of a group of us up here and meditate together. All right, so you can do group meditations and everything. All right? Let me take you over here now. We have art exhibits. Let me take you to one of the art exhibits. The meditation room is above the art exhibit talks. Like we have like a whole park, and the whole park is like a art exhibit. All right, so I'm gonna take you out to one of the art. We have two of these art exhibit parks. Let me take you out to one of them real quick so I can get an idea. And inside those art exhibits, inside those art exhibit parks, we have a open mic stage, open mic poetry, you know, rap, whatever, you know, right there in the actual park. All right, give me a second here. I'm fucking located. Trying to remember what name I had. That particular thing under the East of the Cloud. We got the syllabus. We have Woody Parks in here. We got all kinds of stuff. And I'm going to show y'all something that's really bugged out. Or just the meditation room, open mic. Let me go there a little bit. to get to the open mic stage. It's the open mic stage. And again, we want, you know, we want people in to be changed. You can also change how the skies right now happen for nighttime. For nighttime for the meditation. I'm gonna change this to midday. Alright, so now it's like midday. And here you see I'm up on a stage here. And here's the actual stage up here in light gray. And I can put chairs here and everything. Matter of fact, I'm gonna change the sky. I want the shadow. I'm gonna make it for 12 p.m. Like 12 noon. Benches in here, you can sit down, you just chill out. But there's four big buildings inside this park, with domes on them. Inside these dome buildings is where we're going to have artists in it. So if you're artists, you know, contact me and we'll do a joint venture. We'll put your art exhibit in there and the different things that you have in the art exhibit, say you have different prints. We have the ability to put all those prints on the shirts, hats, watches, clocks, whatever. So people come into the art exhibit, see your artwork there, and say, oh, I like that particular picture there. I want that on a shirt, or I want that on a hat, or I want that on a clock, or whatever, a watch, or whatever. All right, so we have the ability to do all that. So artists, you know, contact. All right, so this is the art park. We have 2 week art park, which is a park with four buildings, and in the center of the art park is the open mic stage. Over mic, rap, all that stuff like that. All right? Now, I'm going to take y'all over to the beach. Got a little beach set up. Little beach boardwalk area. You know, just for a little recreational thing. So I'm going to take y'all over there real quick. And, you know, take you to the boardwalk. Show you that. And then from the boardwalk, I'm going to show you something else that's kind of like bugged out. I love doing things with people here in real life. When I get y'all to come inside there, you know, y'all be able to go and experience all the different landmarks. Yes.
No, go ahead, Mark.
We can get different landmarks. So, huh? What was that?
No, go ahead. It's all, no, nothing.
All right. So this is the World War World I set up. And this major size is what I said, it's part of something much larger. So that's why I said, oh, the secret. I wrote another book called Secret of Secrets. And if you go to that website, secretofsecrets.info, you're going to learn about this whole new thing that I've been creating. I have courses I've been teaching in this. See, we, you know, a lot of times you hear us say, yeah, we gods and goddesses, you know, so and so forth. But we don't really utilize our God power. You know what I'm saying? And so I've come up with a way where we can actually use our God power to actually change reality. I actually came up with a programming language that actually can be used to actually program reality. If this were a matrix, if this were a computer simulation that we live in this world, then that means it's programmable. And if it's programmable, that means you gotta have what? A programming language. And so, in the summer of 2011, that programming language was revealed to me. And I put it together in a book called, in English, it was called Hoplia. It's an actual programming language. So I want y'all to know about that too, because that's the latest thing that I've been working on. And this Matrix 5 is just part of that. It's just one part of that. All right, so here you see, it's still rendering right now because I'm using a lot of bandwidth right now between the live video streaming and then trying to stream this also. But let me just try to get a little word size view of this little recreation area. I think the children like it too because it has little rides, it has a Ferris wheel, it has merry-go-round, and these rides actually work. You know, the children get on it and could actually ride on them. So hold on a second. Let me see. Let me try choppy right now, because again, I'm just so much on things, but here, I'm up in the sky right now. I'm doing that Neo thing, like Neo did in the Matrix, which was flying around the sky. I love this thing. The flying thing, y'all gonna love that. You know, some people come in here after work and just fly around just to decompress. They're like, I had a stressful day at work, so they come in here and just fly around. It's very relaxing. Makes you feel very free and stuff like that. But here's the World War with the rise on stuff like that. And then here's the sand area. So I'm gonna go down to the sand area because check this out. Go down the sand, right? I don't know if I worked on this child in here. She fucked out on this part. I think you took damage here also. You see what happens if you fly down too fast, you actually fall like in real life. Alright, so here I'm on the sand part and I'm walking towards the water, right? So just keep on walking. Don't ask me what happened to my feathers. I'm gonna look at the last region I was in. Disappeared on me. But you keep walking to the edge of the water. You keep moving to the edge of the water. Check out what happened. Just go right in the water. And then boom. I'm falling and I'm in the water now. Again, it's going kind of slow because I got all this stuff on. But what happened is that I just fell in the water. I'm going underwater because we have a whole underwater facility. Underwater. We have an undersea facility. Let me show y'all, see if I can show it to y'all. We have an undersea facility. And in that undersea facility, I got classrooms set up in there and everything. So actually, here you can see the facility here. And in the facility, we have classrooms set up. I'm going to go into the water hatch down here, the little hatch that you can enter. We got fish swimming down here and everything. All kinds of stuff. You can be sitting in the classroom. And the fish is going by you and all kind of stuff. All right, but here's the underwater facility because we're going to use this to do different events as well as teaching too because we have classrooms set up down there. All right, so let's go into the water hatch right here. Which was so choppy, but using a lot of pushing this computer to the limit right now. But here you see some water vehicles. These vehicles you can actually take out into the water. I took some of these out into the water. I remember one time I had one of the brothers in the passenger seat and I was riding wild. Every time I made a turn, the brother was like outside the vehicle. It was so funny. We were just cracking up. I would make a turn and he's like outside the vehicle. It was like crazy. But here, I'm gonna go up one of these ramps right here. I'm gonna show you one of the classrooms real quick. And then I'll show you one other thing, and then I'll hold it for today. I'll let y'all know where to go to register. I'm in the process of the registration form. Right now I have a form on there where you can actually set up an account. Now maybe I'll leave that one. No, I'll see what happens. Form up there. This is one of the, watch out right here. I even have a private classroom with a big bulk door on it. Here, all right. Here I got one of the classrooms out in the open. You see.
He's.
Oh, for real? Okay, well, that one's it. Yeah.
It froze?
No, I just got it. I'm gonna get dropped. Peace, yeah.
Recreation area. You see, we have a space here. We have a cobble.
have pillars here. And here, another one of the homes that one of the members made for me. We have a sister here that makes a shot. She's incredible. She makes homes. We're talking about living room sex, bedroom sex, kitchen sex, everything. You name it. She does it from scratch. She builds the stuff. These homes, she built me. I don't know how many homes are here from scratch. We have about 60 homes here. So what you do is the home is designed such that you rent a home, and inside the home, you create anything. Only in the home can you actually create buildings. So you can create clothes. Like, yeah, I have a whole line of clothes. We have some other members who have a whole line of clothes out. And we're going to be selling those clothes in the store. We're going to be selling virtual products. So we're going to be selling clothes. We're going to be selling virtual furniture for your homes indoor. You can have a party in your house. You've seen in my house, I had a 30-seat classroom in there. You could be getting classes in your home. You could meet with clients. Like, I hold meetings in there. I hold that bar. I meet with different people in my home. You know, I have chairs set up. I have meetings in there with people. You can do a party. You can have music playing. And there's animations for your avatar that your avatar has to be dancing. You know, you could meet somebody in the shopping mall and invite them to your house for a meeting. I mean, all kinds of things. You could practice your alternative medicine, health, or whatever, right from your home in major style. All right, so we have 60 homes. We have 4 shopping malls. We have 4 movie theaters, and each movie theater has 6 cinemas inside of it. We have office buildings with office space. We have meeting halls for groups and clubs and things of that nature. Whatever it is that you want to do, come in here and just let me know. I'm looking for joint ventures. And like I said, these joint ventures, there's no risk, there's no money out your pocket. What we're doing is whatever's made, we just split the profit. All right? So let me give you our website for this. It's matrix5fib.com. I'm just going to go to it real quick on the screen. But I was just about to push them up when we started the lecture, so I don't know
at what point I left it.
So we'll take a look real quick. Let's see what's going on with that. All right, any questions? Call the club, matrix-5fib.com. Any other questions for anybody?
Good. Yeah, no questions, Akeem.
All right, so that's good. That's good.
It was quite extensive. It was extensive today.
Yeah, I know. And so much more. I mean, I just barely scratched the surface. I didn't even hear all the journals. I didn't even hear the thing about the secrets and, you know, the stuff I'm working on now. You know, that's why, again, I'm going to have to go with y'all a couple more times.
Right. It's all
good.
But everybody, you know, if you want to sign up for an account, go to matrix-5.com. And once you sign up, I have to set up right now so that there's a 30-day, what's up here right now? Yeah. There's a 30-day free trial period, so you can come and see what it's like. And if you like it, then at that point, you can opt out. If you don't like it, then, you know, you just unsubscribe and, you know, nobody can take it from you. All right, so you can go sign up for an account. But if you're interested in doing a joint venture, then definitely sign up for an account. Come on inside, let me know, so I'll make sure that I'm in there, and we'll get you started. We'll go take a look at what you have to offer, and we'll start setting up the store, whatever, offers, or whatever you need. All right? So that's one listed for today. I know it. And what time is it? 8. We've been, I guess, for almost 4 hours.
4 hours.
I know. You were telling me too, you said, man, you want, you know, don't worry about the time, whatever. You got 2.5 hours. I didn't know it was going to be close to 4 hours. I really enjoy doing this with the Canaan Landmower, Canaan Moors. You know, it's my first time doing something with y'all. And hopefully, I look to be doing a lot more things with y'all in the days to come. You know, I'm also going to be setting up so that y'all can set up virtual temples online.
Right.
You know, to come in, you do whatever you gotta do, you know, classes, whatever. If you're interested in anything, if you want to do classes, if you're an entrepreneur, if you're an artist, if you're a musician, poet, whatever you're into, it's something that we can do in terms of joint venture, in terms of Matrix 5. So just come holler, you know, and try and get it, you know, ground floor, because I'm telling you, this is about to take off. This is going to be the greedy end of it, really well.
Right.
And it's about to take off. You know, this is the ground floor. Just like I told those Moore back in 1996, when I did that lecture in Brooklyn for New Moore's New Age 2000, and I saw those Moore back in, I said, listen, y'all better get this internet thing. The internet thing is about to blow up big time. I saw them back this 96. You know what I'm saying? And sure enough, exactly what I said in that lecture, all came to pass, even beyond my expectations. So now, with the next game changer, you know, I'm telling more about this now, is with this now. Because we're going to do the next game changer. Just like the World Wide Web, change the nature of commerce and all that. This, the 3D virtual world, is going to change the nature of commerce, all that. This is the next game changer. So get with it, boys.
Right? Yeah.
I'm going to say peace.
Peace, give thanks.
Thank you.
Good
job.
All right, Marvel. You know, I'll give you a shot.
So I'm gonna put up some games.
Yeah.
All right.
All right.
Thanks again. And anybody who wanna contact me, you can go to any of these websites, matrix-5.com, just press the contact button. You have to go to Secret of Secrets. info@secretsecrets.info and just press contact and contact me there. And then you want to become an affiliate and tell any of our products that we have on Ringo, go to allthingsonearth.com. Alright? And just press contact me there. If you're interested in Ringo, just go to allthingsringo.com and you know, contact me there. We got so many websites, so many different things going on, but y'all find a way to contact me through any of those websites and just let me know what you want to do. If you want to sell the journals and make a commission off of that, let me know. I have other publications and, you know, we just get this thing popping. We just all mutually support one another. I have many different ways for the people to make money. You know, joint ventures, you know, all that stuff. Here on Secret Secrets website. If y'all go there, when y'all pick the Secret Secrets, I have to do live meditations on there, y'all can do for free, 8 times a day. So you just go here. Then you go down here, scroll down, and say, listen to this ship radio show to learn what this site is all about. This is where you go to listen to that 3.5 hour show, and it will break down everything. All right, so that's what you can do with this announcement. If you want to contact me, just press the contact button up here. Right, you know, so again, thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Mark.
Hope to hear from y'all.
Look
forward to getting y'all busy with it. Peace.
Peace, Rob. Peace,
Islam. Love it. Peace.